Okay.
You can put it down here.
We are recording. We're on. Alright, so 114 slides to get through today, folks. And I'm gonna do my best to cover them as efficiently. I got my fancy dancy pointer. Test review, I'll send something out over the weekend. So first thing we have to talk about, yes.
Oh, are you ready?
Yes.
And you said you're gonna give us a test review?
Over the weekend. I gotta write the test first.
You mean like Friday afternoon?
What?
You mean like Friday afternoon?
Sometime, I forget that today isn't Friday, but sometime before, how about before Friday, I'll have a test review. Alright.
Do you really have to get that on there?
What?
This presentation contains graphic.
Yes, because I'm gonna show you my boobies. Boom! Yes. Okay, what's up? Formal announcement?
About the annotated bibliography coming.
Oh, yes. Not next week, week after. I'll let you guys focus on your test and then we'll do the annotated bib after that.
Thank you, Whitney.
So, but yes, we are going to talk about assessment. Yes, you are going to see girly parts. That's part of the game, right? But I wanted to start with my boobies. I love this little graphic. It is so funny because I use it when I'm speaking at breastfeeding conferences and stuff. And I say, "Want to see my boobies?" Click. It just makes everyone laugh. Okay. So there were some things about Chapter 4 that I thought you really needed to know as OBGYN nurses. I don't know that you're going to see Chapter 4 on the test. Matter of fact, since I didn't lecture on it, you probably won't. But that doesn't mean I want you to ignore these very important women's health things. Breast exams begin early in life at about the age of 19 and continue every year for the rest of your life for yourself. There is a wonderful app called the Your Man app, which will send you a male stripper in your email every month to remind you to do your self-breast exams. He's like, yeah, he's like a baker, but he's topless, and he goes, "Hey baby, time to give yourself a little TLC."
What is it?
Your Man app. The Your Man app. There is a woman there too, if you want to swing in that direction. It's not all men. It's a hilarious video on YouTube about the Your Man app. It'll crack you up. But it's a great app, and it reminds you to do your monthly self-breast exams. But breast exams should be done routinely, usually done in the shower. You want to cover the entire breast, all the way up into the tail of Spence. Your book forgets the tail of Spence when it talks about breast anatomy, but this is where most breast cancers are found, in the upper outer quadrant. Clinical breast exams are done every 1 to 3 years. Basically, whenever you need a pap, it's a good time to get a clinical breast exam, although most providers don't do it anymore. But we used to teach the breast exam very meticulously, but women don't do it. And so if you go to the Your Man app, they'll teach you the TLC methods, touch, look, check it out. And touch, you just kind of go, about what it was last month, okay. And then look, as you do the Peter Pan pose, and then you raise your hand above your head and watch your breast rise and fall. And then if something is there that wasn't there last month, you check it out. And so it's more of a familiarity. As long as you know your breasts, you're okay. Sometimes you're going to get little bumps that don't belong there. Well, they belong there, you just don't recognize them, and it's just part of your menstrual cycle, and that's okay. So if you find something, that's why you need to know. Well, every time I check my breast, I always feel like this. Don't do your breast exam during your menstrual cycle. It'll confuse you. But if you're going to do your breast exam during your menstrual cycle, always do it during your menstrual cycle. Right? As long as you're familiar with your breasts and you know any changes. Mammograms usually begin around the age of 40. Some recommendations talk about 50. And if you have a first-degree relative, which is who? Mother or daughter. Who has breast cancer? You start your breast exams 5 years before she was diagnosed with breast cancer. So someone who gets it at the age of 38, her daughter start at 33. Okay, they start with their mammograms. Cytology used to be every year. Your book still says, or within 3 years of beginning sexual activity. Nonsense. It now starts at 21, and it's every 3 years for the first three. Provided they're all normal, and then when you get into your 30s, if you have negative HPV, you go to every 5 years. So it's really spaced out. Those annual paps aren't necessary, especially young in life, because early in life, HPV infections are, 80% of you, by the way, have HPV Okay, you just do. 80% of all humans have it before they die. And it means a whole lot of nothing the vast majority of the time. And what will happen is when you first begin sexual activity, you might pick up a little HPV, it runs wild for a year or two, and then the body says, all right, knock it off. Same way it does for herpes and all the other viral infections. It attacks, it fights it, and then it's gone, and then it usually never comes back. So we got a whole lot of false positive ascus and a whole lot of false positive L-cell in our 18, 19, 20-year-old population. And by 22, 23, it was completely gone. So we finally figured out we don't need to mess with them. We're just scaring people for nothing. Okay. So if you had a false positive pap, if you had a positive pap at the age of 18, ignore it. It's gone. Okay. As long as you have negative ones after that. Okay. Thyroid should be checked every 5 years after the age of 50. And why? Well, sure, for hypothyroidism, but why not me? Why you?
Menopause.
No, not quite menopause. It's just that thyroid sucks for women.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
When I die and I get to heaven, I'm going to ask God this question. What were you thinking when you made the human body? What on earth? Why can't the thyroid, bladder, and gallbladder make it till they die? Why do they all go away before they're 45 or 50? It's hard to find a 50-year-old woman who has a functioning thyroid, bladder, and gallbladder. One of those three, if not two or three out of those three, are going to fail before they hit 50. It's just an unfortunate problem. So thyroid needs to be checked every 5 years after the age of 50. And glucose needs to be checked every 3 years after the age of 45. Because what happens with your glucose as you age if you're a woman? You get diabetes. The same thing that enables you to have a baby, enables you to carry a baby to term without killing your baby. Enables you and makes you have gestational diabetes. And if you have gestational diabetes during pregnancy, you are 4 times more likely to develop gestational or diabetes as you age. Okay, it's a much, much higher risk of diabetes in women who have a history of gestational diabetes. Because pregnancy is just a window to the future. Whatever happened to you during pregnancy is going to come again later. If you got high blood pressure in pregnancy, you're going to get high blood pressure later. If you got diabetes, you're going to get diabetes. It's just a window to the future because your body's running along pretty well most of the time, doesn't need anything, and it can run within its parameters pretty nicely. But if it's got a weakness, boy, pregnancy is going to find that weakness and exploit it. Okay? So if you got heart disease, pregnancy will find that heart disease for you. If you got diabetes, if you got whatever, pregnancy will find it. And then when you're not pregnant, it kind of goes back and your body's like, yeah, when I'm not working so hard, I got this. But then when you age and it needs to work hard again, it all comes back. So if you sail through pregnancy without a problem, you get to be one of those ladies who lives to be 150. Health promotion and health screening, very, very important on a regular basis. Remember I mentioned yesterday or last week that it is pregnancy when women enter the healthcare system. The vast majority of women enter it through pregnancy. And so when you're doing your, as the OBGYN nurse, you are the one who's going to be the one who gets all the health screening and all that good stuff. So it's a good time to talk about drugs. It's a good time to talk about safety at home. It's a good time to ask about sex and whether or not you're satisfied with your sexual relationships and all those wonderful things. And that's why the labor and delivery admission to the hospital is like 15 pages long. Because it's like, we're only going to see her this one time. Quick, ask her every possible question. And then anticipatory guidance about what's going to happen throughout life. You know, when I'm doing a new OB on a 21-year-old is when I mentioned. So this year we start your PAPs, and we'll be doing them every 3 years. And any history of breast cancer, well, we'll start mammograms around this time. And immunizations, if you got your immunizations up to date, let's start thinking about your immunizations and when we need to immunize you, that kind of stuff. Okay? So there you go. That's the first 4 chapters. That's what I consider important. Anyway, so reproductive anatomy and physiology. First of all, when we talk about embryos, you know, who can tell me when embryos determine a male and female gender?
At conception.
At conception, exactly. Once the DNA splits, you have either an X or a Y or both, you're squared away, right? That's when your body knows. But we can't usually see it until later on. However, the male and female body are remarkably similar with a lot of analogous structures. Your ovaries are just like my testicles. Your clitoris is just like the glands of my penis. It's very, very similar structures. There's just, you know, more external versus internal and that sort of stuff. So, let's talk about the female body. I'm always amazed how few people know, how few women understand their body well. And as nurses, you are going to be the ones who are responsible for teaching these people this. And then I say I'm amazed, and then I think, well, have I ever shown my daughter this picture? No, I haven't. So does she know her body as well as I do? No, probably not. I probably should show her this picture sometime. So up here we have the prepuce of the clitoris. That's the clitoral hood. That's the thing that people like to pierce, although I don't know why. And then we have the clitoris. Underneath the prepuce of the clitoris is the clitoris, and the clitoris is about 3 centimeters long. It extends into the anterior portion of the vaginal wall, and it is erectile tissue just like a man's penis, made out of the exact same tissue as a man's penis, and just as sensitive as the head of a man's penis. And so, have you ever heard the magic word, the G-spot? Believe it or not, when I was going through grad school, I actually read an article from just a year or two prior that talked about, does the G-spot exist? Okay, that was 15 years ago. People were asking, does the G-spot exist? Okay, because when we do our anatomy look, and you go into the cadaver lab and whatever, and you look at females, female cadavers, do you see a G-spot? No, you don't. Do you? You know that the tissue, you can find it on dissection. You can see that it goes through the underneath the fat pad and through the vaginal wall or whatever, and you can tell it's there. But you can't tell it's erectile tissue because it only erects when it's excited, right? And so it's kind of like saying, well, I look at this cadaver of a man and I see he's got a 4 to 5 inch penis and it's flaccid. Okay, it's always flaccid, but men know better, right? Because you can see a man's erection. It's hard to see a woman's erection, but that's the clitoris. It erects, it forms a mass at the anterior section of the vaginal wall. And if you run your finger across the anterior section of the vaginal wall when you're excited, you'll find it. I promise. It'll jump right out at you, okay? But it's in there, and it's important to know, especially when we start talking about sexual dysfunction and that sort of stuff, okay? When, if the textbooks don't mention that it exists, women will never learn that it exists, and it'll never exist. It'll continue to be that hidden, I don't know, I don't have a G-spot. It's like a man saying he doesn't have a penis. It's the same thing, it's just your clitoris. It's just inside, not outside. Now, let's see here. Let's talk about the labia majora. Keep hitting the wrong button. The labia majora are the large folds on the outside of the perineum, and then the labia minora are the smaller folds on the inside. The labia minora are hairless structures. Labia majora has hair depending on how dark your skin tone is. The darker the skin tones, the more coarse and visible the hair. But all humans are covered with hair. Every pore on every mammal has hair on it. So there is hair everywhere. It's not as easy to see on lighter skinned folks. Let's see here. And then there are the glands that lubricate the vagina, that is the Skene's glands, which are almost impossible to see. You have to like really look close, don't even bother. But if they're infected, they'll jump right out at you, it's obvious. And then down along the bottom are the Bartholin's glands. Skene's glands and Bartholin's glands both produce a lubricating thing, as does the clitoris. With the clitoris, it's called smegma. That's actually the word for it, not a colloquialism, but smegma is the word. And they are pheromone laden. They tend to have a very powerful smell that it attracts men. Mm-hmm. That's what they're here for. Okay, it's the scent, so to speak. Okay, we are animals just like dogs, whales, lions, llamas, cats, and kangaroos. Well, not kangaroos, and we work just like they do. So yes. These the clitoris, the Skene's, and the Bartholin's glands all produce a liquid that is attractive to the male species. And by the way, the man has the same thing underneath his prepuce around his glands, which is, you guys call it the clitoris, and it also produces a smegma, which is also produces pheromones, and it smells differently than women's smegma. Mm-hmm. Or so I've been told. I don't spend a lot of time around men's smegma. All right, and then there's the vaginal orifice. I'm sorry, the urethromeatus, you guys are all familiar with where the pee hole is. Mm-hmm. And then way down here at the bottom, that little opening there, that's the opening of the vaginal canal. Everyone thinks it's really large, it's very, very small. And it's a potential space, it closes in on itself. And everyone thinks this whole thing is the vagina, it's not. That itty bitty hole right there is the vagina. And then, What's that?
Oh, no, everything else is an accessory.
Everything else is an accessory, exactly, like earrings and bracelets and stuff. And then right here, this third fold of skin, right along here, it actually runs throughout the entire inside of the opening of the introitus. It's called the hymen. The hymen is perforate, like as soon as you are born. You could not have a menstrual cycle. You could not bleed if you had a perforate hymen. And that's usually how we discover imperforate hymens, is during when a girl should be menstruating, she's not. She'll have a lot of pelvic pain, she'll have like difficulty peeing, and it'll hurt, and they'll go and check her out, and they'll find this imperforate hymen. It's actually a quasi-birth defect. It's one of those, 14% of all babies have a minor birth defect. It's one of them. But that hymen starts out relatively small and then opens as you use that organ more. And the more you use it, the more open it gets, the more easily accessible it is. And when you go to labor and delivery and you actually get to look at a patient's actual laboring vagina, birth canal, you can see the hymenal ring on the inside of the vagina. It's usually on the inside of the birth canal, usually about half an inch or so into the birth canal. And it's this jagged tissue that's kind of like this. Up there, there's a little spot here, a little spot there. It kind of looks like an old Roman wall that's been knocked down 2,000 years ago and is still there. It's just there. You can see a little bit of it here and there. And that's because the more intercourse you have, the more that gets knocked out of the way and pushed back. But yes, the hymen has nothing to do with virginity. It is a cultural myth that the vagina has anything to do with virginity. Yes, ma'am.
So then what's causing the bleeding, though, during the first time?
The hymen, tearing, sure.
Okay,
remember, it starts
okay.
Small and it gets bigger.
Okay.
And so the first time you have intercourse, it's this small, tight organ. Anybody who's ever been, what's the word I'm looking for? Celibate works, but anybody who hasn't had intercourse for like a year and then has intercourse might recognize that it hurts when you first start having intercourse again. A little bit of dyspareunia, the first week of resuming intercourse, is extremely common, because if you don't use it, you lose it. And so just like if I march every day, my feet are going to get tougher. If you have sex every day, your vagina is going to get tougher. And the less you use it, the more it hurts.
Okay.
Extremely common among the military population. Husbands deploy for a year, and then when they come back, they're like, it hurts when I have sex. It'll go away. Slow down, use a little more lubricant, it'll get better. And then, of course, there's the perineum, colloquially known as the taint.
Yep.
Taint this, taint that, right? And then, of course, there's the anus. Okay. So there are several holes there to know about. Neither one should touch each other. You want to keep them all away from each other. What goes in the vagina shouldn't go in the urethra. What goes in the anus shouldn't go in either hole. Okay? It's very, very important stuff to know. And it's why women get urinary tract infections so more commonly than men, because the recreation zone is right next to the waste dump. What rubs along here gets pushed into there. It's called a honeymoon UTI. Women will, when they haven't had sex for a while, will have sex and a week later get a UTI. And it's like, what the heck happened?
Yeah.
Yeah, just you hadn't had anything rubbing up against there for a while. And when all of a sudden it did, it just pushed this bacteria into there. Okay?
Slip and slide.
There you go. And then, of course, there's the penetrating nature of intercourse takes any bacteria that would be on the urethral meatus and forces it into your itty-bitty urethra, right? Which moves us on to the next one. This is it from the side view. This is obviously a non-pregnant woman. We'll start with our ovaries and our uterus. We'll talk about them more a little bit later, but the uterus at rest is about the size of a pear, very, very small organ, with enormous potential space. It's this small, fat little thing, and it grows to this enormous, thin thing. Okay. Then you've got your bladder, which comes up and sits over behind your symphysis pubis, with an itty-bitty little urethra. The female urethra is about 3 centimeters long. And that itty-bitty urethra is what makes it so easy for females to get urinary tract infections. Because there's not a lot of space from here to here, and so any bacteria that makes it here can easily travel there, and then it easily makes it up into the bladder, into the kidneys when you're pregnant. And so, whereas men, with a 4 to 6 inch urethra, there's more distance from the outside to the inside. They don't get urinary tract infections as often. Then there's the clitoris, and this is a better view of the clitoris. From the outside, you just see that little nubbin. From the side view, you see that it goes all the way up into the body and comes up underneath the symphysis pubis along the anterior surface of the vagina. And you can see it's a little bit like an iceberg. From the outside, you see the itty bitty little pea. But on the inside, and just like the penis, by the way, women's clitorises vary in size from very small to very big. I've actually seen women who had extremely large clitorises that look like little penises. They never get as big as a penis, but they sure can get large.
So where would the G-spot be on there?
The G-spot is right here. So you go into the vagina and then top, and then across the top.
Okay.
Let's see here. What else is important from the side view? And other things from the side view, you see. So here's your symphysis pubis. There's the fat pad. What's that called? The Mons
pubis.
Mons pubis, exactly. And the fat is there, here, and here to protect the bony structures under here and under here. Okay. Now, the vagina, you'll see that the vagina it has ridges. These ridges are called rugae. And they allow the vagina to expand. It gives it more potential space. It folds in on itself several times. And you can feel those rugae on the inside of the vagina. I'm sorry?
Like a straw, like a bendy straw?
Yeah, they're a little bit like a bendy straw. Yeah, those flexible straws, so they have those little ridges that fold on themselves. And then back in here, right behind the cervix, is the posterior fornix. And this whole area here is called the cul-de-sac. Okay, just the back of the vagina. Okay? I know, it's a cul-de-sac, right? And of course, the vagina has five functions. Lubrication during intercourse, to stimulate the penis. I thought that was an interesting one, to stimulate the penis. The warm, fleshy folds stimulate the penis, because a man doesn't just orgasm out of nowhere. You know, they need a little something to stroke him, right? And that's what the vaginal rugae do. A receptacle for semen, and to transport the semen to the vagina, or to the uterus. And it is the end of the birth canal. Now, ovaries and uterus. So here we have our uterus, nice little pear-shaped organ, 2 to 3 centimeters or so in size, about the size of a small pear, and is made up of three portions. There's the corpus, which is the upper portion of the uterus, which makes up the fundus and the body of the uterus, and then the isthmus, which is this little section here. And then the cervix, which is obviously the end of it. Okay? Part of the uterus is this Soverian support ligament structure back in here called the broad ligaments. There are also round ligaments that support the ovaries. And those round ligaments, right there, so the round ligaments and the broad ligaments are what gives women that pain in the first 20 weeks of pregnancy, that round ligament pain. Okay? It's that these things are connected to the uterus. And where the uterus goes, they follow. And I don't know if you know anything about ligaments. They don't stretch.
Right.
Okay, ligaments are not designed to stretch very well. When these ligaments stretch, they gripe about it. Okay, and so they're stretched as far as they can stretch. I can just barely hold on. And then mom does something foolish, like reach above her head or cough or sneeze, and stretches it a little bit more suddenly, and that causes a spasm around those ligaments to yank them back down again. So she'll reach above her head and get a sharp stabbing pain, usually on one side of the uterus or the other, and it makes her ball up like that. Okay. What I tell all my patients is good news is it won't kill you. The bad news is it'll make you wish you were dead. And all you can do is apologize. Reach back ahead and go, ow! Oh, I promise I'll leave you alone. And when mom shortens herself down again, she moves that uterus back to its normal place and takes the pressure off of those broad ligaments so she doesn't have so much pain. We usually associate pain in front with round ligament, pain in back with broad ligament, but it doesn't really matter. We just call them all round ligament pain and leave it alone. It's just that everyone thinks that there's like these ligament structures around the uterus are just one little rope, and they're not. As you can see, it's a big fanning structure that holds everything into place. It holds the ovaries close to the uterus, holds the uterus into the cecum. It puts everything where it belongs. Okay, so that those ligament structures are very, very important. Now, in the uterus, there are three layers: the perimetrium, myometrium, endometrium. Kind of self-explanatory. The perimetrium is what?
Outside.
Okay. Myometrium is in the middle, and it's made out of muscles. And then the endometrium is the one on the inside, right? So the perimetrium around the outside is kind of thick and fibrous. It looks like the outside of a smooth muscle. It's extremely smooth, and it's just a covering, a casing. Okay, and the myometrium is where the actual muscle of the uterus. In your book, there's a wonderful picture of the muscle fibers of the uterus. They are interlacing bands like this. They wrap around themselves and they crisscross each other so that when they can tighten down and make a whole circle shrink at the same time. What's really cool is they're interlaced with blood vessels. So you've heard about like the fundal massage. Whenever a woman has a baby, we have to massage and keep that uterus nice and firm, because the firm muscle closes off all those blood vessels so she doesn't bleed from her placental bed. Okay? It's a pretty neat little trick. You would think you were designed to do it or something. You are. Okay? And then the isthmus of the uterus, right in through here, tends to get extremely thin during labor. And that's the section where if we have to do a C-section, we go right through the isthmus, which is underneath the contractile portion of the uterus and above the cervix, right in here. Is a nice area, a nice easy place to enter, because that section with no contractile forces of the uterus means that the next time mom goes into labor and all of this is contracting, this won't contract. And so it's safe to do a vaginal birth after C-section because there's not a lot of contractile space in the isthmus of the uterus. That's also, by the way, if you do if you fail a trial of labor after C-section and you get a uterine rupture, that's where it's going to rupture, and they'll poke right out through there. And sometimes when it's really bad, you can feel the baby pop out of the uterus. Never had that happen, thank God. That's right, that's my wood. Okay. All right, bony pelvis. I love the bony pelvis. I was such an idiot toward the bony pelvis because planes and angles, they just don't make a lot of sense to me like they should. I was such an idiot that when I went to grad school, I had to get a pelvis and carry it with me everywhere I went, so that I could remember the pelvis. And I would get up and walk away and go, Tom, you forgot your pelvis. Because I don't have a pelvis like you have. I have to have one to feel and explore in order to learn. I'm a very visual, tactile kind of guy. So this is the bony pelvis. It is obviously the base of the spine. And it forms as a nice little basket of the pelvis. And the male and female pelvis are similar, although differently shaped. But the same thing you learned in anatomy class still applies. You know, you have the sacral promontory, that's best that right there. That's the sacral promontory. You have the sacrum, which runs down there to the coccyx at the very end. You have the symphysis pubis that's right here in the middle. Notice that that's cartilage there, okay? That's not one bone, that's three bones, right? That's iliac crest, which comes down to the ischial tuberosities and joins together at the symphysis pubis. And then again, back in here surrounding the sacrum is another joint, right? Mm-hmm. So when women have hip pain and pelvic pain in pregnancy, it's the SI joints back here, or it's the symphysis pubis. And it's a circle. And if you tweak one, the other has to tweak in the opposite direction. And if you tweak it too much, you put a lot of strain on that symphysis pubis. Any woman who's ever been pregnant felt a lot of pain right there. That's strain on that symphysis pubis. They can actually break, they can separate, they can do all kinds of horrible, horrible things that will leave you immobile for months. And that's not easy to do when you're trying to be a new mom. But on the bone itself, they make a difference between the ischium and the pubis as though it's two separate bones. It's a complete circle. It's just the back side of the circle is the ischium. The front side of the circle is the pubis. And you'll notice that little bump on there. When you get to do a cervical exam, I want you to find the cervix. If you're lucky, you'll find the cervix, okay? And then once you've done the cervical exam, just sweep along the sidewalls on both sides, and you'll find a little bump on the sidewall, okay? That little bump is right there. It's the ischial spine on the inside, okay? And that's how we determine station. When we say if the baby is minus one station, plus three station, it's where they relate to that little bump on the inside. Okay, and we use these bony anatomy structures to make measurements. Okay, you don't really need to know the measurements, but you need to know that the measurements exist. And there are some basics that you need to know about, like the shapes of the pelvis, which I'll get to on the next slide. Now, important thing to understand, if you did your reading, you read about the true pelvis and the false pelvis? Mm-hmm. Who can differentiate the true pelvis from the false pelvis? What is a true pelvis?
Sorry, what was the question?
What's the difference between a true pelvis and the false pelvis? What is it about the false pelvis that makes it the false pelvis?
Is it not holding the false pelvis?
Okay, all right. So, you know the pelvis is a basket, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's more of a funnel, okay? On the top, you have this big, broad opening space between the iliac crests. That's the false pelvis, okay? Mm-hmm. Then it slides down, and it forms a perfect circle. That circle is, that cylinder, actually, is the true pelvis, okay? So when we're looking here, you see, there's the false pelvis up here, the basket, mm-hmm. and the true pelvis is the circle. Okay, they've cut away the middle here to give you room so you can see the other side. But this circle right here is the true pelvis. Okay, and the true pelvis runs from the linea terminalis to the outlet, which is the base of the ischium. And the ischium, most people call those your sits bones. Okay, because when you sit down, feel those two bones you sit on? Those are your sits bones. Those are the ischiums. And you can feel those ischiums really easily. If you have a woman lying on her back with her in the lithotomy position, knees flexed, feet flat on the bed, and you reach in on the inside, on either side of the vagina, down a little bit, you'll feel the sits bones. You can press on them, and you can find them. You can do it right through the clothes, obviously. Wonderful chiropractic technique to relax the pelvic floor muscles by just pushing in on the inside of the sits bones while you take a deep breath, and then as you release, you just hold it. And then when they take a deep breath in, you push in a little further, and then they release, and you just hold it there, and you get further and further into the true pelvis, and it recalibrates all the muscles in the pelvic basket. All right, you don't need to worry about it. I got distracted. So there are four different types of pelvises. Okay, gynecoid, anthropoid, platypoid, android. I thought it was interesting. Your book suggested 23% of women have an anthropoid pelvis. An android pelvis. I've never seen it that high. Never. Okay. But what it is that it really is very rare to find a true Caldwell-Molloy style pelvis, that every pelvis is a combination of the different ones. You know, Caldwell-Molloy, they're looking at all these pelvises, and like, yeah, they kind of look alike. And so they said, these that look like this are gynecoid, and these that look like this are platypoid. Well, what are the ones in the middle? Gynecoid, whatever, okay? As a general rule, the gynecoid is the traditional female pelvis. Most women have a gynecoid pelvis. It's large, round, and deep. It makes a nice birth canal, and it gets much, much larger as you get more pregnant, okay? The rest have an anthropoid pelvis. Anthropoid pelvis is most commonly associated with Africans and African Americans. The whole baby got back syndrome is real, okay? The baby got back is the anthropoid pelvis. They're tall and heart-shaped, but they're very deep in the posterior section. If you know any black women who had babies, most of them will talk about having back labor, will talk about having a lot of pain in their back. A lot of them will talk about the baby was upside down to the last minute, and then he came out face down at the very end, or baby came out looking straight up. Okay, that's occipital posterior, and it's associated with women who have an anthropoid pelvis, which is very deep in the tailbone. And that baby got back is that big tailbone sticking out. Okay? My daughter's got a big butt. She's gonna have that too, the poor thing. But her mother had 8 beautiful babies with hardly breaking a sweat. She probably won't have too much trouble. Okay? So, but the anthropoid pelvis is tall, heart-shaped, deep in the posterior section. Platypoid, platy meaning plate-like, right? Mm-hmm. Platyploid is a flat pelvis. They tend to be very narrow from top to bottom and very wide on the sides. And it's difficult to have a baby through a platypoid pelvis. Very, very difficult. And then the android pale is the male pelvis, which is small, heart-shaped, and narrow and thin. So the heart-shaped anthropoid pelvis and the heart-shaped android pelvis are similar. It's that the anthropoid pelvis is tall, heart-shaped. So it's like an elongated, like an oval-based heart. Mm-hmm. Whereas the android pelvis is a small heart with bigger wings on either side. Okay, it's very narrow from top to bottom. And I love it, those those, there's a video out there that we see on YouTube from time to time, and it's got a, it's like this x-ray screen, and it's got two skeletons kind of walk together and do something, and then they leave, and everyone's like, oh, it was two men, oh, it was two women, oh, whatever, right? Mm-hmm. Once you understand the pelvis, so the first time I watched it, I was like, oh, those are gay guys. And then oh, that's a pair of lesbians. And that's really the point of it. But you can see it from a mile away once you understand the shape of the pelvis. If you've ever watched like CSI or any of those crime scene things, they talk about, oh, this is a woman, age 24, and she was blah, blah, blah. It's because they're looking at her pelvis. Okay? The male and female pelvis are incredibly different, and that allows you to have a baby and makes me, you know, die if I try. Okay? Your book has a wonderful table on it. Yeah, it's this one here on page 141. Wonderful drawings and descriptions. Very, very good stuff. All you really need to know is that there are four types, and that the gynecoid and anthropoid pelvis are good for birth, and the platypoid and android pelvis and not so good. Okay, the book says can't have a baby. That's nonsense. Okay, it certainly makes it harder. But all, you know, I've seen an awful lot of that'll never happen.
Right.
Okay. Happens all the time.
That's when you say positioning of the mother is extremely important when you're birthing.
Exactly.
Like that, right?
With every pelvis type, there are different positions that you need to use in order to facilitate birth. We'll get into that a little bit later. Breasts are are accessory organs of the reproductive system, meaning that they are not used for reproduction, but they sure do help, okay? And so they are modified sweat glands called apocrine glands, and every mammal has them, and they evolved from very, very early in mammalian evolution. We believe that early mammals would create this substance that would leak out of their underbelly, and they would coat their eggs with it, and they would coat their young with it, and that kind of stuff. We still see that today. There's a sponge that lives on volcanoes at the bottom of the ocean, and that sponge secretes this gooey stuff over its offspring to protect them early in life. So it's that kind of thing has been around for a very, very long time. And in mammals, they simply developed a set. It went from a sweat gland that secretes an oil to a mammary gland that secretes a nourishing liquid. Okay, very similar to the marsupials have a very similar gland inside their pouch that the babies nurse off of while they're inside their mother's pouch, and that they use later. And they swallow their nourishment the same way our babies do, but ours are on the outside. A wonderful organ. We'll talk a lot more about them when we talk about breastfeeding. But it's important to understand that they are primarily glandular, fibrous, and adipose tissue. The differences in size of breasts are almost always adipose tissue, which is why if you gain or lose weight, your cup size will change. But it's oversimplified to say that all women have the same size glandular tissue in their breasts. They do not. The larger-breasted women tend to have more glandular tissue and tend to have more milk storage production or milk storage capacity, whereas smaller-breasted women have less storage capacity. So there's a little difference in glandular tissue after the baby is born or during the pregnancy. Before, however, the glandular tissue of a prepubescent girl is pretty much all the same right up until they get pregnant. Interestingly enough, you guys remember Tanner stages? The five Tanner stages, right? And you learn about breast buds developing early in life, and you know at the beginning of menarche. We'll talk about that a little bit later. But the breasts don't actually finish. They don't actually hit Tanner stage 5 until after you've nursed a child. They're stuck at Tanner stage 4.5 until then, because they certainly almost look like mature breasts, but they're not. And if all of you were my patients, I could look at your breasts and tell which one of you had or had not been pregnant. Okay, pre-pregnancy breasts look very different than after pregnancy. They tend to be more rounded just basically more developed after they've been used for lactation. It's a subtle difference that you wouldn't see in an anatomy textbook, but the lactation consultants recognize the difference of, you know, pre-pregnancy and post-pregnancy, and you guys will too by the end of this. Their primary function is lactation. The breasts are not made to sell beer and sports cars, okay? Interestingly enough, the only reason that breasts are sociologically considered attractive is because a woman in the, you know, ancient days who had big hips and big breasts could survive childbirth and nurse their offspring. A woman with narrow hips and little breasts couldn't survive childbirth and wouldn't nurse their offspring very well. And so when the man is looking for a mate, he looks for the woman who has large breasts and large hips. And that's why all artwork right up until 2005 or so, showed these voluptuous women who had curves all over the place. Now all of a sudden they're talking about the hammock and the gap. It's just so, you guys know what the hammock is? What? The hammock and the thigh gap, they go together. The hammock is if you're wearing a little bikini, if there's a space from your iliac crest to your mons pubis, and you can see a little gap between the bathing suit and the skin. Okay, so there's a little gap right in here. It's called a hammock.
You need to be super tight.
Where it's like supported on either side. What's that? Yeah, that's very skinny. And then again, the thigh gap, that little gap at the top of your thighs right before you hit the taint.
I haven't seen that
since
I was
that falling. Little gap. I think it's most people won't. It's in the last 20 years or so, we've become more and more toward the thinner frame. You know, Victoria's Secret and all that wonderful stuff. But those women don't do well in childbirth. They just don't. You know, they need a little curve on them. Because Where does the body store estrogen? Anyone know?
In fat.
It's why gymnasts don't have menstrual cycles, because they don't have enough estrogen to menstruate. Okay. Anyway, we're digressing. But the primary function of the breast is lactation. Okay. They are here just to feed your baby and for nothing else. After that, they're just cancer cones. It's like, please give me cancer. That's all they're for. All right. Yeah. One of my obstetricians called them cancer cones. I just love that phrase. I had to steal it. The primary parts of the breast are the nipples, the areolas, the Marion Montgomery tubercles, and the talus pens, or at least those are the parts you can see from the outside. It's important to recognize there's a difference between a nipple and an areola. Okay, the areola being the large portion, the nipple being the small pointy part, and the areola is the nipple is the erectile tissue. There is some erectile tissue in the areola, but not much. It's mostly in the nipple. And then Montgomery's tubercles, you know, what are Montgomery's tubercles?
Where the milk comes out.
Nope. Those are called nipple pores, where the milk comes out. What's that?
Don't they get
fat? Not the fat. They sure can. They can get infected. Usually, if there's an infection in the breast, it's in the lactational ducts themselves on the inside. Montgomery's tubercles are on the outside. Remember what did I say? Bless you. Remember what I said about the breasts? What did they start as?
Oh, the lubricant.
Sweat glands, exactly, and they release a little oil, a little sebum. Montgomery's tubercles are these little dots all the way around your areola. If you mess with your nipples, you'll find there's itty bitty little bumps on your areola that kind of circle the nipple. Those are the Montgomery's tubercles. And they release an oil that lubricates the nipple. For when it goes in the baby's mouth, it moves back and forth readily in the baby's mouth. Okay? And then, of course, the talus pens, I mentioned that earlier, that's the upper outer part that goes up into the axilla. Okay? That's important, one, because women forget about that when they do their self-breast exams, and you have to remind them to get up into there. But two, how many women have extra nipples? How many women have more than two nipples?
There's a lot of
10 to 15% have extra nipples. Okay? They are usually, they look like a little mole right here, right where they're right at the ribs, right underneath the emery gland themselves. Or you'll find little moles up here in the armpits. And when you have little moles in the armpits, I've actually seen them leak breast milk. Yep. They develop during pregnancy and they can leak breast milk. It's pretty cool stuff. So you look at yourself in the mirror and be like, I have a little mole here. And every once in a while, women are embarrassed by it. But all mammals have 8 to 12 breasts in embryonic development. And they run from the human axilla right through the breast, down to the base, right to about the bottom of the rib cage, just a little bit above the navel. Okay? All mammals have them. Now, mammals who have large litters, like pigs, dogs, they develop extra breasts, or they develop those breasts to feed their babies. What's really cool is they lose the breast as soon as they finish feeding their baby. So if you have a sow who has 8 little piglets, and you take one piglet away, she'll have 7 breasts. And you take 2 piglets away, and she'll have 6 breasts. Until she has just one piglet, one last little guy weaning, and she has one breast. And humans are the only mammal that keeps their breast when they're not nursing their offspring. We're the only one. All the others get rid of them. We don't. Yep. Now, they change dramatically, but when we're finished, we still have breasts. I think, however, that's more a reflection of body fat than it is glandular tissue. Okay. If you look at videos, pictures, whatever, of the 1800s, 1900s, you'll see that most women had like no breasts. Okay, very, very small. Almost everyone was an A cup. Today, almost everybody is a D cup. It's very interesting.
Are you saying naturally?
I think it's just we're getting bigger. Remember I mentioned that the World War II infantryman was only 5'2" and weighed 105 pounds? Most women aren't 5'2" and weigh 105 pounds. Okay, yeah. We're just getting bigger. And part of bigger is more body fat, and part of more body fat is more pronounced breast tissue, because it really likes to store body fat there. Okay? And then, like I said, you should do regular self-breast exams with clinical breast exams every 1 to 3 years. Very, very important. The Your Man app, it's a stitch. I love it. I have it on my phone. I'll show it to you guys if you want to later. Because I use it to teach. I use it to teach with. I whip it out and show. Okay? Now, we're going to get into some really, really complicated stuff. Okay? Hormonal regulation of the female body is an incredibly complicated thing. We're going to try to break it down from big to small and make it easy to understand. The beautiful thing about hormones, now I hated them when I was in my undergrad. Hated hormones. They were the worst things in the world. I was miserable at them. I couldn't tell the difference from estrogen and prolactin. I was a mess, okay? I've learned to appreciate them. And what's really important about hormones, we give them a bad rap, right? Hormones are, you blame everything negative on hormones, right? Oh, I'm hormonal. Oh, is it your period? Whatever. Okay? And when women are pregnant and they're crying, it's just the hormones. It's just the hormones. Right?
Yep.
It's a bunch of crap. Okay? It is our hormones that make us who we are. I absolutely love hormones. It takes a hormone to blink. It takes a hormone to sneeze. It takes a hormone to contract, to orgasm, to love, to hate. Everything is hormones. Okay? Sometimes there's an imbalance of hormones, and it makes us a little bit emotionally labile. But every thought you've ever had your entire life is a response to a hormone. They are just chemical messengers within the body, and if you didn't have them, you wouldn't be here, okay? You'd just be a quivering pile of jello, a vegetable in the corner somewhere with no emotion. So we absolutely have to have them, and I love them. So we're going to start with the big hormones, okay? The big hormones. What's that? Sure, go ahead. Do we need a potty break?
Yes.
Okay, fine, take a potty break.
It's your hormone.
We haven't even been here an hour. It's at lunch. Every hour. Oh my goodness. I was watching folks kind of dance like little kids. I kind of have to go.
Experiment.
Yes, ma'am. No, but they will be. I didn't want to give away all my jokes. Right? You guys are all so hot to get slides. I post slides and then I change them like crazy.
This is still chapter 5, right?
Yes. Only 48 minutes.
I need to pick a man. Check out the hotties who remind you who look for fuel.
Why are you going?
Aw, the brother's a little baby one. I like only give you like one type of man. I want like a...
What are you doing? I'm gonna see what men we have.
She's on her period.
That's the hormones.
That's the new line now. It's the hormones.
See, I don't like a man with a hairy chest.
Oh no, we can't have no hairy chest now.
And this, like, he's like dark skinned, but he like has like a little like, peach bug.
Belinda has CD too.
Oh, okay, that's good.
Check out the hotties who will remind you.
This Asian guy is cute too. He's a little slim though. Oh, they even have a fully tattooed person, Rachel.
Do they? I'm all over it. Have your breasts had some TLC today?
There's not very many types of girls. Oh, there's also a doctor. So he just wanna have a doctor.
Oh really?
But it's not the doctor, it's like on
the pastor.
So it's like your study?
The Atlanta plastic. Wait,
old pillows.
I watch
that. There you go.
Yeah.
I do.
And did
you see
the
one
with the oh my god. And I was like, did you really sing this rap song?
And
I
was people like, yeah.
I was looking for like a Latin level, but I didn't really. I saw one, he looked like dark.
I'm not on one.
Just
this
one.
Guy looks kind of like.
Oh, is that the app?
This is the app.
That is the app?
It's like everybody else
just because it's cute. He's not bad.
They have like a straight up doctor on here, so they
don't have to. I mean, because he can be cute, but he just looks like.
What's wrong with
him? Where's Michael Bailey? Wow. Okay. I want to see that movie.
But it's not my favorite. As good as like, you look at these, look at this one. Look how tall they are.
Look at his face. Like, you just have to look at his abs.
Like, I need it to connect, you know?
Right? Look, I mean, come on. Look at those abs.
I mean, it's okay with the rest of them.
Can you customize the app?
That's what I'm wondering.
I don't know. I have to pick my guy first.
I'm just saying.
Can you put a filter in
there? I would like this guy. He looks a little bit landlubber like.
Okay.
I don't like the hair on the chest. So that's why I was like a smooth.
Yeah,
but I could tell it. Yeah. And his arms. How much are you? Oh, but they had his lady on there the other day.
Okay, I need a client.
She put, what do you call it?
Okay, you picked your man. Sounds good. Did you watch the video?
I haven't watched the video.
Oh, the video is a stick. It is so funny. Your man app.
It's got a pink reminder.
It's got a pink torso. A pink man's torso on it as a symbol.
Like, you can't tell.
Your man reminder.
But the advertising for that is hilarious. This guy is. You know, talking about, I'm Dr. So-and-so, and I'd like to teach you about breast exam. But since research shows that you'll pay more attention if it comes from a good-looking man, I want to introduce you to Bob. And Bob is this, you know, stripper, topless, and he's doing the whole thing. It's hilarious. They talk about doing the breast exam in the shower, and he's like, with the water blowing on him.
That's
how
I said
I think it comes
on Fridays. I have to
bring
it.
It's
just so
good.
I don't know if you watch
Bring
It, but I
just
don't.
Oh, the
guy that I
picked,
his name's Jesse.
Oh, yeah, the name. Oh, okay.
Hey, Jesse.
All right, are we ready to start? Let's start.
No, I'm like, it's so good.
Oh,
but I'm in such
a hurry. It's the hormones. Yeah, it's not like you going into the guy's bathroom over here. You really just have one.
I said you can use the boys' room.
Maybe I said that. Oh,
yeah.
So you found a way to get the hormones?
Yeah.
Very nice.
It starts big and it goes small.
Okay. This is like our second or third time going over hormones.
Oh, good.
It's still kind of like, blah, 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 blah. That does not mean we know him so well.
Yeah.
No,
I just like to leave. Don't mistake that for.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, for sure.
All right, so let's get started again. Like I said, it's going to be on video anyway. So if I go too fast and you need to watch it again, it'll be on YouTube. So we start with the hypothalamus. The hypothalamus being the main endocrine organ of the body, and it produces a few big boy hormones that are really kind of everywhere. Now the beautiful thing about hormones, what I love about them most, is that most of them are named after what they do. It's like saying the tie your shoes hormone ties your shoes. Okay. And all you need is a little bit of medical terminology to understand it. Okay? So gonadotropin releasing hormones releases what?
Gonadotropins.
And what is a gonadotropin?
It has something
to do
with gonads.
Right. Gonads, okay, which is ovaries and testicles. Mm-hmm. Tropin acts upon them, okay? So gonadotropin means that this hormone acts upon the gonads, right? Mm-hmm. So a gonadotropin-releasing hormone is a hormone that tells the gonadotropins to get to work, okay? So the gonadotropin-releasing hormone tells the gonadotropins to get those ovaries and testicles up and running, okay? Mm-hmm. They don't, it's not the one that makes the ovaries and testicles work. It's the one who makes the ovaries and the ovary and testicle controller work, okay? So it's like the grandparent to the parent to the child, okay? Exactly, this is the boss's boss, okay? This is the big one from the brain that controls big stuff. Okay, and then there's the corticotropin-releasing hormone. Mm-hmm. Again, corticotropin. The corticosteroids, the corticosystem, is the system that deals with upregulation, with fighting for stress, with fighting stress and controlling the immune system and that kind of stuff. So corticotropin-releasing hormone releases the corticotropins, okay, to get to work. Growth hormone-releasing hormone, growth hormone-inhibiting hormone, obviously the growth hormone, is the most or the second most ubiquitous hormone in the body. Prolactin and growth hormone are extremely similar. They run one and two. Depends on who you ask which one is the most. Pediatricians like the growth hormone, lactation consultants like prolactin, but they run almost every structure in the body. It is either run by growth hormone or prolactin. So there's the growth hormone releaser and the growth hormone stopper, right? Mm-hmm. One gets it going, one makes it not happen. And then there's thyrotropin-releasing hormones. Thyrotropin is the what?
Thyroid,
exactly. So it releases the hormone that makes the thyroid, that signals the thyroid to work, okay? It doesn't control the thyroid, it controls the hormone that controls the thyroid, okay? And then there's the prolactin-inhibiting factor, which obviously inhibits prolactin. So that's the shutdown, okay? That control comes from deep in the brain instead of somewhere else. All right? So those are the five hypothalamus hormones. Yes, or
so
six.
So TSH stimulates it to release.
Right. Thyrotropin-releasing hormone stimulates TSH to release. Exactly.
Okay.
These are the big bosses. Okay? This is the president and his cabinet. Okay?
Yeah.
If you want to use analogies. Then there are the pituitary gland hormones. These are the smaller guys, okay? These are the bosses. These are the ones that you hear of the most. The thyroid-stimulating hormone obviously stimulates the thyroid. That's TSH, okay? Adrenocorticotropic hormone, ACTH. You guys all learned about that in adult health. That's the one that works in the kidneys and that kind of thing. It kind of upregulates the body's defenses, okay? Obviously, adrenocorticotropic is stimulated by the corticotropic hormone, right? The corticotropic-releasing hormone, okay? Prolactin sounds very much like what it does. Interestingly enough, with prolactin does not make milk. I know everybody has heard prolactin makes milk, and it says prolactin, so it makes milk. It's not, okay? Prolactin allows milk to be made. Okay, it's not a controlling hormone, it's a regulating hormone. The process runs on its own, and prolactin decides how much is going to be left over. It actually closes the inside of the breast so that it makes the lactiferal sinuses as little bags that don't leak. Without prolactin, the bags leak, and you can't hold any milk. Okay? But prolactin is found in over 300 structures in the body. It's in your hair, it's in your teeth, it's in your bones, it's in all of your organs, it's in your lungs, it's everywhere. Okay? It is most dramatic in the breasts, but it's everywhere. Okay? So prolactin comes from the pituitary gland, from the anterior pituitary gland. Growth hormone does just that. It makes things grow. And gonadotropins are the follicle-stimulating hormones and the luteinizing hormones. Okay? So those are the gonadotropins, the follicle-stimulating hormones and the luteinizing hormones. They always run hand in hand, and I think of them as twins. I think of them as thing one and thing two. Okay? They are very, very similar. One works on the ovaries, one works on the uterus. Okay? But they're very, very similar. Okay? Then we have the hormones released by the gonads, estrogen, progesterone, testosterone. All of us in this room have all three of those hormones to different degrees, okay? To be simple, estrogen is the get busy, plan the rest of your life hormone, okay? It is what makes women type A people, okay? It's why they like to plan and do, they like to organize, it's estrogen, okay? Progesterone is the fat and lazy, sit on the couch, eating bonbons hormone, okay? It slows everything down. What's that? That's what you got, right? There you go, yeah. So estrogen is responsible for tissue development, for maturation of tissues, for growth of the breast, for growth of the uterus, growth of the ovaries. Estrogen makes everything happen, okay? Progesterone slows things down, makes them easy going. All right? It's progesterone that makes the uterus not contract. It's progesterone that allows that stops the breast from working. It's progesterone that that slows down the women's immune system during pregnancy so it doesn't attack the developing baby as a foreign invader. Okay? So estrogen speeds everything up. Progesterone slows everything down. And the two are usually in balance. Okay? In pregnancy, however, they're not. In pregnancy, the first part of the pregnancy is ruled by progesterone, which is why anybody who's been pregnant knows the first trimester is fatigue and bloating and constipation and I can't get out of bed and I have no energy and it's hard to breathe. That's all progesterone. Okay? The second half of the pregnancy is all estrogen. And that's why the second half of the pregnancy is fantasizing about your baby, going through your thoughts, watching the breast grow, excited. There's a second honeymoon that happens in the second half of pregnancy.
Nesting.
What's that?
Yeah, the nesting.
Nesting. All of that is estrogen related. Exactly. So estrogen speeds up, progesterone slows down. When you're taking a test, and I say the hormone responsible for constipation is estrogen or progesterone?
Progesterone.
The hormone responsible for breast development, estrogen, progesterone.
Estrogen.
See how easy it is?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's a great question.
Okay. And then the last one. Yeah. It's not going to be that simple. And then testosterone. Testosterone is only one hydrogen away from estrogen. They are incredibly closely related. Okay. Very, very close. But they have dramatic differences in how they work in the body, okay? Again, testosterone is an anabolic hormone, right? It's a builder, okay? It's what makes muscles develop. It's what makes aggressive behavior happen, that kind of thing. It's definitely not a calming hormone, okay? It's an exciting hormone, okay? Just like the estrogen. Very, very similar. But it's often related to muscle development, muscle growth, and whereas estrogen is related to endocrine growth or glandular growth, okay? All right, other hormones. Human chorionic gonadotropin. Who can tell me what that hormone is?
Does it tell you if you're pregnant?
It does, it tells you if you're pregnant.
Yep.
Where does it come from?
Pee.
No. It's excreted in the pee.
Like once you
what's that?
Like once you
conceive,
sure. In your body.
But it doesn't come from the anterior or the posterior pituitary gland.
No.
It doesn't come from the ovaries or the testicles.
Cryon.
Where does it come from? The chorion.
Yeah.
Okay. Human chorionic gonadotropin. And what is the chorion?
Who told you gonadotropin?
Dr. Kessick's
going to
kill you.
We didn't go over this. We didn't get reproduction.
We didn't get
We skipped reproductive systems when we did AMP.
That's fine. You all had reading assignments.
I read it. No,
he
I
didn't
know
say
it.
That.
I read. No,
it comes from the placenta.
Okay,
it comes from the chorionic layer of the placenta. There's an amnion and a chorion within the placenta.
I knew it had something to do with maternal health.
And early on, it comes from your
corpus luteum.
Thank you. Comes from the corpus luteum early on. Okay. And then prostaglandins. You guys are all familiar with prostaglandins. They are pain-producing hormones. And relaxin. Relaxin. When I first started in this field, we talked about relaxin, but there was a lot of doubt as to whether or not it truly exists. Okay? Is it relaxin that makes everything relax, or is it prostaglandin that makes everything relax? Your book is pretty consistent on relaxin makes everything relax, so I'll go with it. Okay? But relaxin is not measurable in the blood. We can't really find it. So we don't really know what relaxin is, but we believe relaxin is a relaxing hormone. It's what gives the joint laxity in the musculoskeletal system that you see, and what allows women to stand up straight while they're pregnant and develop that pregnancy waddle. You've all seen the pregnancy waddle? Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's relaxin. Because everything has to kind of swing and sway in order to survive pregnancy. And that's on purpose. All the joints are really loosely put together, and pregnant women have a lot of musculoskeletal complaints because the relaxin loosens up all their joints, and they just kind of loosen floppy. And when you've got a joint that's kind of loose and floppy, it pinches and it catches and it rubs where it shouldn't rub, and it pops out when it shouldn't. And you hear women talk about, I stepped up and my leg went out on me. And that's because their hip was just a little bit out, they put weight on it, and it snapped out, and it'll pop back in when they stand up again. But yeah, but that's relaxin. Okay? Pretty simple, right? The releasing hormones are the big guys. The supervising hormones come from the anterior pituitary gland, and they impact on the gonadotropins, or the gonads, and then the gonads do this. Now's where it gets complicated. Now's where you kind of have to start memorizing. Okay? So, menstrual cycles are often drawn in circles because they are very circular, very repetitive. They happen over and over and over again every 24 to 35 days. It always starts with menstruation. Why? That's kind of in the middle, right? And yet it always starts with menstruation. Why does everything start with menstruation? Why is it the first day of your last menstrual period instead of the last day of your last menstrual period?
Because they have the hormones
rising. No, it's a circle. You can pick any point in a circle. Why do we like the first day of the last menstrual period?
To make sure you're not pregnant.
How hard is it to remember the very first day you saw bleeding?
Yeah,
it's hard to remember.
Well,
actually,
this is true. But what's harder to remember, the very first day or the last day? Or the day in the middle? Or the day that you got middle schmerz? Okay,
middle
schmerz, we'll talk about it. So, the very first day of the last menstrual period, the first day there was visible bleeding is the first day of the cycle. Just because it's an easy, giant, red flag, okay? It stands out, you can put it down on your calendar, you know you started bleeding today, okay? There's all these warm-ups, like, I think I'm going to get my period the next couple of days. I just don't know. But everybody has that one day that they start bleeding, okay? It's universal to all menstruating women, okay? So it always starts with menstruation, and then it runs through, okay? We start with these low levels. During menstruation, we got these low levels of estrogen and progesterone, and then and that signals the hypothalamus to kick in and make some more estrogen and progesterone. And it makes it by stimulating the gonadotropin-releasing hormones through the anterior pituitary gland, which then stimulates the gonadotropic hormones, which stimulates FSH and LH to make estrogen. And then as estrogen rises, FSH and LH make more estrogen. Okay, it's a positive feedback. The more estrogen you have, the more FSH and LH you have. The more FSH and LH you have, the more estrogen it's going to make for more FSH and LH. Okay? Follicle-stimulating hormone, FSH, does what?
Stimulates
Stimulates the follicles. And where are the follicles? In your ovaries. Okay? It's FSH that makes the ovaries respond. Okay? And in luteinizing hormone, where is the corpus luteum? In the ovaries. So is luteinizing, I know I said placenta earlier on, I apologize. Luteinizing hormone is it forms and supports the corpus luteum. So what happens is, you know that little bitty baby girls are born with about 400,000 to 500,000 eggs in their ovaries. What's fascinating is if you've ever made a baby girl, you made your daughter and your grandchildren at the same time. Because you are born with all of your eggs already created in your ovaries when you leave the uterus. How fascinating is that?
Okay.
Yeah, you do. They're just not here yet.
If you only made boys, you didn't really make any grandchildren yet. Your sons have to make your grandchildren for you. But if you made girls, your baby girl is born. You were born with all the eggs you will ever have, and your mother gave them to you. How fascinating is that? It's called DES was an anti-nausea medicine that we gave to women back in the 60s. Diethyl strabismus or strabilate or something like that. It went away long before I was born. But it was known to cause female reproductive cancers in the babies whose mothers took DES during pregnancy. And so we used to ask every pregnant woman or every woman as soon as we saw them, did your mother take DES? We need to know. Okay? Because they could get cervical and uterine cancers. Okay? And then we thought, well, when those women left reproductive age, and by the way, all those women are in their 60s and 70s now. Okay? That's how long ago DES was. We thought that we would be done with DES exposure when they left the reproductive age, okay? Because those who had it would have gotten their reproductive cancers early in life and they would have died or survived or whatever, okay? But lo and behold, we found it in their grandchildren too. And that's where it hit us. That's where it hit the researchers. I say us, like I was involved. That's where it hit the researchers that, oh, because the eggs are formed before the baby is born. So anything that you were exposed to, your daughter is exposed to, her daughters were exposed to. So we were finding DES-related cancers in grandchildren, which is, that's unfortunate, okay? That is the only teratogen that will, only teratogens that affect the ovaries will pass through multiple generations, okay? Normally, if you're exposed to a torch infection, it ends with that baby. But if it affects the ovaries, it'll affect every generation. Well, at least the next generation, okay? So that's the LH and the FSH, and so they stimulate the estrogen to increase, stimulates those. And I like to think of this, when I was trying to memorize this for my tests, I drew a cartoon of the menstrual cycle bakery, okay? And I had, I would get the hypothalamus house called Aunt Pitt to tell FSH and LH to get to work. And so they called the FSH and LH, and these little thing one and thing twos, they went to work in the bakery building shelves and making dough and getting everything ready to go, okay? And the harder they worked, the more shelves that they needed. And that proliferates the endometrium of the uterus and gets it ready for the menstrual cycle. And then if the baby came, then they would actually have to package and ship the bread and get it out. But if the baby didn't come, then they had to take all the shelves down and put it away, and then they could go back home. Okay, and that's how I remembered it, as I drew a little cartoon of little thing one and thing two, making the dough and doing all the other stuff. And there are other hormones involved that you don't need to know about that they were adding in to their little mixtures. So as estrogen increases, FSH stimulates more estrogen to increase through positive feedback. You end up with ovulation. Okay, in order to ovulate, the uterus selects 5 follicles, usually 5. And it prepares 5 follicles, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, okay? And then one of them becomes the dominant follicle, okay? Dominant follicle is the best of all the follicles that month. And it releases, the dominant follicle releases an egg, and the other 4 will settle down and support the dominant follicle, who turns into the corpus luteum, Okay? It's pretty neat. It's not just one egg. It's five possible eggs, and only the best one gets to go. Okay? And there are theories. Has anyone noticed that the older child is always the best child?
No.
The older child, I know, if you're not the oldest child, you're gonna be sensitive to that, right? But it's the oldest child that gets the best grades, is the best in sports, and they tend to be the top child, right?
Yes. Yeah.
And the earlier you conceive, the better the older child is, okay? Because the absolute best egg, the absolute best egg that your ovaries make is the first one it releases. Okay, that was number one out of 400,000. Most of them are wasted. Nobody's getting pregnant when they're 13, right?
Well.
There you go. And they have great kids, by the way. They have great kids. Because they got those super eggs. When you're 30, when you're 26, believe it or not, you turn the corner when it comes to fertility. That's the peak, and then you start to go down.
26?
Yes, 26.
You're gonna tell me I'm
going to
peak in 5 years?
Yep.
Wait, get on it.
Absolutely. I didn't even want my first kid by the time I was 26.
Absolutely. You peak at 26. So you creep, you kind of creep along until about 13, 14, then you take off like a rocket, you peak at 26, then you start to decline. That's okay, if it makes you feel any better, men peak at 18, and then they start to drop. So we're way early. Yeah. So you peak at 26 and then you start to go down. And after 26, your fertility decreases. And you're getting the older eggs. You're starting to get the rejects, the ones who went up for it, not so much. Yeah, not so much. And that's why women who are more than 35 have more Down syndrome. Women who are 40 have more Down syndrome because they're getting the old, rejected eggs that aren't so good anymore. Yes. What's that? We have no idea what's causing autism. We don't know. It's probably something in our grass, something in our water, something in our air. I'm pretty sure it's an environmental toxin, but I don't know what it is. Because it came out of nowhere, okay? And we just haven't found it yet, okay? So anyway, so your follicles, they mature 5 follicles, they release the dominant follicle in the bottom 4, and the bottom 4 end up settling back down again. Forms this corpus luteum. The corpus luteum produces more estrogen and progesterone, and it supports the pregnancy in the first 8 weeks, okay? And so you'll often hear people, like early in their pregnancy, women will get a lot of pain on one side, and they'll get this ovarian cyst, and it's an ovarian cyst from the corpus luteum, okay? And I tell people, your ovary's jobs are to make a cyst. Every month, your ovary makes 5 cysts. Once in a while, it's going to turn into an ovarian cyst that's going to cause a problem. But most of the time, it just settles back down with the menstrual cycle or after ovulation happens, okay? But yeah, the ovaries make cysts. That's what they're here for. Sorry, that's the way it works, okay? I didn't design it. I'm just telling you about it.
Just explain it.
That's right. And it's usually broken down into 3 phases, a menstrual phase, proliferative phase, luteal phase, okay? We're going to see a better diagram of this. For that part, just what's important here is to understand that it's a circle, okay? That it starts with menstruation, and through positive feedback, one hormone leads to another hormone to respond until menstruation, okay? Now, let's talk about sexual maturation. Puberty is heralded in females with thelarchy and menarche. Everyone knows what menarche is, right?
Yes.
What's thelarchy?
There
you go, breast development, exactly. It's when breast buds start forming. Thelarchy comes first, menarche comes shortly thereafter. So we start with breast buds forming, and then a year or two later, we'll get menarche, okay? And everyone likes to think of the body as though there's somebody in there flipping a switch and making things happen. And it doesn't happen like that. It gradually accumulates until it happens, which is why teenagers have irregular menstrual cycles. And people are always hot to put them on birth control to regulate their menstrual cycle. No, they're just irregular menstrual cycles because they're learning how to do it. And every month, the HPO gets better and better and better. HPO is hypothalamus, pituitary, ovarian cycle. HPO, that's what that cycle is called.
Okay? But what about females? My sister had really, really, really bad cramps. Like
sure,
to the point where
sure. I think it's just menorrhea and that kind of thing, and they need to be treated.
Oh, okay.
But irregular menstrual cycles don't need to be treated,
okay.
Especially early in life.
When you say okay. irregular, you mean like, okay, I know what irregular means, don't get me wrong, but like, what if you go like a significant amount of time without having?
Doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter.
All it does is freak you out thinking you might be pregnant, but if you're not having sex, then you're probably not pregnant, right? But the problem with it is, so in the 50s, we developed this need to control everything, okay? And we set these guidelines in the 50s. There's the FDA came out, and everything was government certified, regulated, this is and that, okay? And then in the 60s, they came out with birth control pills. Do you guys know why birth control, why the menstrual cycle is 28 days?
Because they said so.
Because they said so. Because it happens to break down nicely into four, okay? So 4 times 7 equals 28. And that means that every 4 weeks on a Monday, your period can start. That is literally why menstrual cycles are 28 days long on birth control pills, okay? They are very, very tightly regulated in that, you know, there's the, you know, the 21 days and then or there's the 24 days and then 3 days of placebo or 7 days of placebo, whichever type you want to use. And so that you will always start bleeding on the same day. And you can predict your period is going to come on Monday. And that's why they tend to start them on Monday, because who wants to have a period over the weekend? And so, you know, they start on Monday morning. That's literally where all that came from. Has very little to do with physiology and everything to do with control of the menstrual cycle to make it into 4 easy to follow weeks.
So all that other confusing stuff about month or days to put on your little pack, all that, like, it's all confusing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Let's just confuse you.
Yeah. You could skip right over all your placebos and just take them straight for 3 or 4 months in a row and never have a period.
That's really
Yep. We think that you should have a period when you're using that method every 3 or 4 months to kind of wash things out a little bit.
Right.
But it's because you don't want to have this this hyper proliferation. Okay. But anyway, but menarche it starts very irregularly. Okay, and then it becomes more and more regular as your ovaries become really good at it. Okay, and then they run like clockwork for a few years, and then it starts to become irregular again. And so there's this premenopause, menopause cycle, where for about 5 to 10 years, you start to get these irregular menstrual cycles, and then they eventually will get further and further apart until they stop altogether. So it's a little bit like a light bulb burning out.
Oh, wow.
As it goes on. I'm so sad. I'm sorry. I happen to be a boy. I like analogies. I'm sorry. Male sexual development or male maturation begins with testicular enlargement. Okay, much easier, and it just happens. I don't know much about men. I just kind of throw them aside. I know what happened to me. I know what happened to my boys. I don't know anything about why. It's the wrong species. I don't know much about it. That's what you learn in Adult Health 1. I read an interesting article. Have you ever noticed that anatomy textbooks don't have the preface of the male penis?
Yes.
They take the foreskin off.
They take the foreskin.
So when you're studying it, it's like it never existed. And if you don't happen to study anatomy and learn about it or have a child, there's actually some pretty good internet articles about a woman who had a son who was like, what the hell is that on his penis? Not realizing that the penis actually comes with some foreskin.
Yeah.
Like every other mammal out there. But yeah, because it's not in our textbooks. It's not in our high school public health books. It's not anywhere. And I was looking in your book. If you look, it kind of draws an analogy to the preface, but it just makes it look like skin outside of the erectile tissue rather than an actual separate piece of skin. It just looks like the actual skin of it. Anyway, but so puberty begins with the testicular enlargement. And then there are secondary sexual characteristics, and that's breast development and a widening of the hips. So they start with the little buds, that's thelarche, and then as you move through adolescence, they become more developed. They tend to be kind of pale without a lot of differentiation between the skin and the areola, and there tends to be, it's a more smooth, rounded appearance, whereas after breastfeeding, the nipples remain darker, and they remain more clearly differentiated between the two, and they lose the smooth, round appearance. I always think of like water, little pink water balloons before pregnancy, and then afterward they look very, very different.
Okay.
Yeah. All right. And so it's breast development and widening of the hips, and so everything kind of widens out in here. All right. And that's a good thing. Now, We're going to talk about the menstrual cycle first in text, then in pictures, okay? So there are two parts of the menstrual cycle. There's the uterine part and the ovarian part. And that gets a little bit confusing sometimes, okay? So the uterine portion of the end of the menstrual cycle is the menstrual phase, when you actually menstruate, right? Usually lasts 1 to 5 days. Proliferative phase, what does that sound like? Proliferation, right? That's when everything is building up. The FSH and LH are making those shelves, getting things ready, right? Secretory phase, that is when the ovaries are actively secreting and getting ready to, that's when if you notice it's day 14. So that's ovulation to implantation, okay? That's when the ovaries have secreted, they've let the follicle go, they're releasing the, they've got the corpus luteum supporting the follicle, everything is being secreted and ready to support the birth of this, to begin this baby. And then if secretory phase fails, then the ischemic phase, that's just, you know, everything shuts down. Blood supply decreases, estrogen decreases, FSH, LH decrease, and it ties it off and lets it fail, okay? And then it starts with the menstrual phase, okay? What's that?
I was just saying, our body goes through a lot.
It does, it does. It's an amazing process, it really is. Damn right, fascinating. Yes?
The days are a little bit different.
Sure.
In a scenario where you may, you know, be like, hey, it's day 7, or something like that, mm-hmm. different on yours, but in the books, the days are just, it doesn't matter.
Because you'll see those days in your figures, okay? I didn't create these slides, I modified them a little bit.
Like this one has like a 1 to 6 days.
1 to 6?
And that one says 7 to 14, and then that one says 15 to 26, so that's
what
I was saying,
you know.
This is the one
that's 31 days. Where's that figure that has the menstrual cycle? It's got a woman standing next to it?
Page 144.
144. Do the numbers match that picture?
Oh, yeah, it sure does.
There you go.
Okay.
And it's it doesn't matter. I'm not going to say what happens on day 5 versus what happens on day 6, okay? Because that's foolishness. Remember, we talked about how a 28-day cycle itself is foolishness. The average menstrual cycle is anywhere from 24 to 35 days, okay? 35 is a long menstrual cycle. Okay, but it's not uncommon to see it. So, you know, 28 days just gives us a rough draft framework to think about. Okay? I don't know very many women who actually bleed for 5 days. Usually it's 3 to 4 days, but 5 days is not uncommon. But 3 days is more common than 5. But it doesn't matter. But that's the endometrial phase of the ovarian cycle, of the menstrual cycle. It starts at the end with the bleeding, okay? And then it starts to rebuild, proliferates the inside of the uterus. Then it's the ovaries secrete and kick in, and they've got all kinds of hormones going to support pregnancy. And then when it doesn't work, it fails and it goes ischemic. And it dies, and it ends up back on day 1 where it bleeds, okay? And this is called the hypothalamic pituitary ovarian cycle, HPO. You may see HPO an awful lot. That's the way I say it, the HPO cycle. It is so much easier than hypothalamic pituitary ovarian cycle, okay? But it's the hypothalamus, the pituitary gland, and the ovaries create this cycle, okay? And then there are the, from the ovarian side, there's the follicular phase and the luteal phase, and we're gonna look at that here, okay? By the way, I don't do this very much, okay? But, pay attention, okay? One more, just in case anyone's confused. You will see this again. You will see this over and over again, okay? But you will definitely see this on September 1st, okay? Or something like this. This is incredibly important to women's health, and you need to understand it, okay? So, this is a rather complicated chart, and it runs through everything. You kind of have to try not to look at it all together. Look at it in pieces, okay? So, we start with our follicle-stimulating hormone and our luteinizing hormone. They dip, and then they spike. And you'll see that they spike right before this big dividing line. This big dividing line is ovulation, okay? So there's a little dip and then a spike. By the way, that little dip and spike coincides to basal body temperature, okay? Your body temperature dips and then spikes after you ovulate, okay? So this happens, and then a day later, everything else happens, okay? So there's the menstrual phase. Menstrual phase is the bleeding, right? Then there's the follicular phase. That's the building of the follicles on the ovaries. And the proliferative phase, building of the endometrial lining. Remember, two things are happening at the same time. Uterus is preparing, ovaries are preparing. And they run side by side, okay? So you've got the LH and the FSH, which stimulate everything to get moving, okay? And as they rise, your estrogen level will rise, and it will create, and that's what creates this, okay? So you see the estrogen level starts to rise, and it spikes right there with these guys. See how they all come together? Okay? Because what does estrogen do? It builds, and it increases, right? And what does progesterone do? It slows down and it maintains, okay? Which is why the progesterone spike is later, when it's at the peak of this building section, all right? And just when the ischemic phase begins, it drops off, okay? So does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Right? So in the ovaries, we have the menstrual phase, ovaries are quiet, okay? Follicular phase, LH and FSH is stimulating, leading to ovulation. And then the luteal phase is the protection. FSH and LH aren't needed anymore, okay? Because estrogen and progesterone are regulating this part, right? And then they start to rise in order to come back over here and start that process again, okay? So, primary follicle, mature follicle, releases the ovulation, releases the follicle, releases the egg, then turns into the corpus luteum, and then it degenerates and it starts all over again, okay? I hope that makes perfect sense. No, obviously, this is the bleeding.
Yeah, now that you explain it like that.
And you will see it again. I love to make this a bonus question where I say, draw the hypothalamus pituitary ovarian cycle. Okay? After I talk about telegraphing it, you will also see questions related to it, too. It is the FSH, the LH surge that causes a temperature change. Yes or no? That kind of thing. Okay? Body changes. If you've ever heard about natural family planning, you've ever talked about symptothermal methods, about maintaining awareness of the HPO axis, this is where it comes from. Okay, the body changes are pretty significant. These hormones change in here like crazy. Spinbarkite is the elasticity of the cervical mucus. You actually take the cervical mucus, you rub it between your fingers, and see how far it'll stretch. The stretchier it is, the more fertile you are. The more the easier it breaks, the thicker and more tenacious it is. So it won't allow sperm to enter the cervix if it's a big thick block, right? But if it's nice and thin and stretchy and watery, it lets it in. So right around ovulation, it becomes very thin and watery to allow sperm to enter the uterus. Okay.
Do y'all check that?
What's that?
Do y'all check?
For infertility, they do.
That's
yeah, they have a basal. They have a basal body temperature drop and surge, and they run into the infertility doc, who then takes a sample with his fingers and goes, "Hmm." Yep.
So, are there patients that because it's too thick, they can't conceive?
Yep. Yep. What happens? What it means is when it's too thick is that they're not ovulating. Okay. So and then there's ferning or crystallization. I meant to post a picture of it. I one time accidentally caught this on a slide. It doesn't look anything like your book.
No.
It was a really fascinating picture. Like, wow, look at that. What is that? And then we're like, whoa, whoa. It took us forever to figure it out. She thought she had a pelvic. She thought her water broke, and it didn't. It was crystallization of the cervical mucus. Anyway, and then increased basal body temperature happens after ovulation. Okay. When the woman has had her temperature spike, ovulation was yesterday, okay? Now, it's okay because the ovum's gonna last a little while, but even more important is the drop in body temperature right before the spike, okay? And then middle schmerz. Middle schmerz is abdominal cramping due to ovulation. You'll notice right around day 14 of your menstrual cycle, a lot of women will feel a little bit of pain here or here, Okay? And that's the actual pop as it releases the egg. Yes?
Okay, I don't know if I just like heard you wrong or I'm just confusing myself. So your body temperature increases after ovulating, but there's a spike immediately before.
It dips immediately before and then it spikes after.
So your temperature spike immediately prior to ovulation.
Correct. I'm sorry, I put that in there wrong.
Okay.
It's a temperature drop immediately prior.
That's why eggs are kept in like freezers and stuff, right? I mean, I don't know if it makes sense.
Well, they're kept in freezers because if you keep something cold, it'll last longer in the body. So we keep everything cold if we want it to last. Okay?
So
but no,
so
they should be right around 98 degrees, you know, at all times to keep them fresh. But yeah, it's a temperature drop and then a spike. We'll talk about it again later.
Okay?
And then middle schmerz is the pain associated with the release of the fallopian of the follicle. And you can, as I understand it, if you're paying attention, you know which ovary released the egg that you can see from, because you're like, oh, this middle schmerz was here, and so that's the ovary that released the egg. Yep. Now, as you age, you start to enter the natural sensation, a cessation of menses. The climacteric phase is that late phase just before menopause, and then there's the premenopausal phase, which can last anywhere from 5 to 10 years. And premenopausal, your estrogen level decreases and your FSH increases. If we're trying to figure out if a middle-aged woman is entering menopause, we test her estrogen and her FSH. If her FSH is high and her estrogen is low, we know she's entering menopause. We know her ovaries are starting to not respond to FSH. And the exact same thing happens if your thyroid fails, right? If your thyroid fails, what happens? Your TSH drops and your free T3 and free T4 will spike, okay? Because the hey get to work hormone is being ignored. And so more hey get to work hormone is produced in order, hopefully if we get enough, this guy will get to work. And the poor ovaries or thyroid is like, yeah, I'm worn out, I'm not doing that anymore. I'm done. And so you get this spike in FSH and a drop in estrogen, and it's a signal of menopause. And it's where the symptoms come from, okay? It's where the hot flashes come from. Because, of course, FSH is the thing that makes the follicles stimulate, makes the follicles release, makes you ovulate, right? But if you're not ovulating and you've got this FSH going crazy, you're going to get that temperature spike associated with FSH, right? And it's not going to go away, because it's not a little temperature spike, it's a constant, get to work, get to work, get to work. So you have these hot flashes, night sweats, temperature instability problems. There's a fancy word from in your book, I meant to write it down and I didn't. It's something instability and I'm blanking on it, I'm sorry. But and also you have, because there's no estrogen, you have atrophy of the birth canal, right? Or atrophy of the vagina and the mucous membranes, amenorrhea, hypopigmentation, all of those things come with a decrease in estrogen. Because it's estrogen that made your vagina nice and pink and puffy. And it's estrogen that gave you menstrual cycles. And it's estrogen that makes your skin do the beautiful things it does during pregnancy. Because those are all increases, okay? And the mood changes, you know, because estrogen is very closely related to testosterone. And so when it's not working right, you're getting all these crazy, you know, crazy side effects from the lack of estrogen, okay? And so that's where the menopausal, they're actually premenopausal symptoms come from. And if we give you a little estrogen, we can make that better, okay? But it's only temporary because it's gonna stop anyway. But the trick is to give a little bit of estrogen during the premenopausal phase to keep people steady until it just all quits altogether. It's really the FSH that's causing the problem. But if I give you a whole bunch of estrogen, your body will stop making FSH. Neat trick, huh? Except, of course, now estrogen has been lumped together with cancers, and we stopped giving hormone replacement therapy to a lot of women. It's not really true, by the way, but we'll talk to the gynecologist to answer that one. And then menopause. Menopause is defined as 2 years of amenorrhea. Okay? When you've gone 2 years without a menstrual cycle and you're in your middle age or more, that's menopause. And so these symptoms are temporary, they only last a few years, bless you. And then it all goes away and you settle out again. And menopausal women don't constantly have hot flashes and all that stuff, because the FSH stops too, okay? And it really is the FSH that causes problems. And then there's postmenopausal, which is at the end of life, somewhere after 60 or 70, and you just kind of ride out until the end. Okay?
Quick question.
Yes.
What, the new medication that just came out that's approved by the FDA that's for postmenopausal women after, so that they don't have painful intercourse, what, how is that?
You must be talking about the pink pill.
Yes, yeah. Pink pill.
I haven't researched it yet. I know it exists, but I haven't played with it.
It's a lot of commercials.
Yeah.
And you don't have to deal with it.
She was in her silk though.
Yeah, it's like you're lying.
I don't watch TV, so I don't see commercials, so I don't know what you're talking about, but okay.
That might be a YouTube video you have to see.
There you go. Now, male reproductive system, okay? Much more tightly compacted, the male reproductive system, because we don't have to put a baby in here, so we don't have a lot of potential space in the male reproductive system. We have the same symphysis pubis, but you'll notice that our mom's pubis is much, much thinner, okay? That our urethra is much longer, and see, they kind of make it look like that's not a separate piece of skin. They just make it look like it's the skin that covers the glands, but it really isn't. There's a separate piece of skin that runs from here and kind of comes to a point down around here somewhere. Okay, but this right here, this glans penis and the corpus spongiosum is analogous to the clitoris. It's exactly the same, only larger. Okay, longer. But you'll see the urethra, of course, runs all the way through. Interesting thing about the man's reproductive system is we have a prostate, and the prostate surrounds our urethra, and it creates a protective fluid to enter through the seminal vesicles into the semen, and that protects the semen from the vagina, because the vagina is a horrible place for semen. And the vagina does everything it can to kill as many semen as humanly possible. And so semen have to be, you know, the Navy just hates the vagina. No, I'm kidding. Maybe that's why the Navy's always gay. Because semen hates the vagina, right? That's funny. I never thought of that before. I'm going to have to remember that next time I'm around Navy guys. So anyway, in the male reproductive system, the seminal vesicles secrete protective glycoproteins, and they pack the semen and get it ready to go out into the world, okay? Semen is made in the testes, matures through the epididymis, travels through the epididymis, adds its seminal fluid here. Very little of a man's ejaculate is actually semen. Very, very little. It's like 3% is actually semen. Most of it is seminal fluid coming from the seminal vesicles.
So in like male infertility, not only like low sperm count, but could it be problems with the seminal vesicle?
It certainly
like
could be.
The fluid that they release?
Sure could, yep. So most of the time when we talk about semen analysis, we're talking about the motility and the number of the sperm and that kind of stuff. But then there's also like the morphology of the sperm. And then let's talk about the seminal fluid. And they test the seminal fluid, the most common is antibodies, where the man's antibodies actually, the seminal fluid is actually poisonous to the semen. So with those guys, they have to get the sperm out of here and wash it and prepare it and put it inside the woman. And that's artificial insemination, okay? We'll talk about that a little bit later. When I was an undergrad taking anatomy, this one young freshman said, Mr. Smith, why is it that only men seem to get prostate cancer? And he said, for the same reason that only women get ovarian cancer. And she was like, we're like, are you kidding me? You don't have the organ, you can't get cancer in it, okay? But, you know, it goes back to, if we don't teach them, they don't know, right? And that's what college is for, okay? All right, I have just a couple more minutes. Male hormonal influences. Androgens make the sex hormones. Predominantly the testosterone, and it causes the secondary sexual characteristics, which is hair growth and that kind of stuff. Fertility is often related to the number, size, shape, and motility of the sperm, and age-related development of male reproductive system. As we get older, we fall apart just like you guys do. Mm-hmm. Okay, but we don't need to worry about it too much until we start talking about infertility, and we'll talk a little bit more about it. Let's take a little break and come back at 3 o'clock. Isn't it fast? How amazing how fast an hour goes by?
Yeah. Yes.
Uh-huh. be the easiest way to take care of that.
Yeah.
Watch that middle smirk.
Saying all that stuff.
You know where
middle
smirk comes
from,
right? Anyone ever been to Germany?
Yeah.
It's German. It means pain in the middle.
Yeah.
That's literally what middle smirk means.
What's that other one?
Spin bar test? That one I don't know. It's also a German word, but I don't know what it means.
And then that's what I'm saying. I'm like, so is that what you're gonna go to Dunkin'? And I'm like, let me see, what's going on here? I'm like, it's warm, wet, not yours. Me gloves on.
Well, of course they wear gloves.
Well, in this case, that's why I was wondering.
That's because that's a woman's hand. That's you checking your own sort of thing.
Or wait, it was a lady doctor. How do you know it wasn't?
Because she's not wearing gloves. What's that?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not sure.
I can't believe we have to stop for 10 whole minutes before we can get started again. Break time.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Wait, you showed me that.
That was on the show, wasn't
it? Was
which episode? Oh, no, I didn't get to that
yet. Yeah, I think it was this season.
I just finished the game.
Yeah, she is. She's like, why is everybody?
I just have something I wanted to tell everyone. Class officers, I know you have MUSNA officers. You need to consider about class officers. Same thing, president, vice president, treasurer, secretary. Do you want to keep the same people as MUSNA, or do you want to vote for other ones? You need to figure that out, and then let me know. Just send me an email, okay, so that I know what you're thinking, that you're going to vote on it. We need to vote on it. And Professor Matthews and I will come in class next Tuesday, and we'll do whatever it is that you know, if you want to keep the same as MUSNA, just to keep it, you know, copacetic. If not, that's something for you to discuss as a class, okay?
I don't know who want you in charge of two things.
Class officers. How you guys want to do that?
Oh, I thought we had a class.
You have MUSNA. No, you have a class representative. We don't have the juniors have officers. You don't. We want you to have officers. We want to keep it the same as MUSNA.
Oh, I don't care.
You guys can talk about it next Tuesday, because then Professor Matthews and I will come in, you know, for class. The junior has a president, VP, secretary, treasurer, and representative.
Well, you can write on your resume and put in your portfolio and say, I am.
That's very good.
See your last.
We survived last
year. I just don't know.
I know.
So you need a subject
for the class.
We got a long way to go and a short time to get there, so we got to get moving. For some reason, that song just hit my head, and I was like, we got a long time to get here.
Oh, is that what it is?
So, yeah. I'm going to kind of breeze through this, because I really want to get to fetal development and genetics, if I can manage it, okay?
Okay.
Sexuality, reproductive health, okay? Very important to understand. your sexual health becomes your mental health, okay? And it's very, very important to control and manage that. It has great implications. Pregnancy is one of those times. It's a milestone, okay? When we start talking about pediatric developmental psychology and we talk about generativity versus stagnation, pregnancy is a part of generativity. And so the inability to reach pregnancy is a big deal, okay? It causes a lot of problems, so it's important to recognize how important pregnancy can be in the health of women. And so as an OBGYN nurse, there's an awful lot you can do that is not birth-related. Working in gynecology, working in infertility, working in GYN oncology, there's a lot of other stuff, and all of these things play an important role. And you'll see this over and over and over again if you haven't already figured it out. That's what nurses do, right? Educator, counselor, care provider, that's what nurses do. So let's talk about the human sexual response. Human sexual response. Who's read up on Masters and Johnson, 1966? Groundbreaking study. They discovered that, believe it or not, sex is not only good but good for you. Okay, and they actually started trying to identify the sexual response cycle. Okay, and I don't remember if gender is on the next slide or if I took it out completely, but we have to give a little bit of attention to the idea of gender identity. Okay. It's a controversial topic, especially when you get away from boy and girl and they like each other, okay? Once you step outside that, it starts to become controversial because we just don't know what it is. Is Bruce Jenner a woman because he says he's a woman? Now, I know he has an X and a Y chromosome, okay? The positivist in me that likes to measure and identify things would say no. He's a man who has a mental illness called body dysmorphic disorder, and he doesn't agree that this is who he is. If I had anorexia and said I was incredibly fat and I ate and I starved myself to death, no one would say that body dysmorphic disorder needed to be supported. They would say, no, that's a bad thing. Okay? There are people out there who take off their arms and legs. They actually think that they should have been born without an arm or without a leg, and they will go to great steps to have their body parts removed because of body dysmorphic disorder. Okay? So the desire to cut off one's penis is the same as the desire to cut off one's foot or hand, in my book. Okay. That said, we recognize that this condition is everywhere. Okay, and the more we talk about it, the more we see it. Okay, statistically, it's something like 3 to 7% of men are homosexual, and 7 to 10% of women are homosexual, and I think a total 14 if you include bisexual into the whole thing. So you are going to see homosexual women in your practice from time to time, and it's just important to recognize that they exist and try to pick up on the subtle cues of homosexuality when they offer it. Usually when I recognize it, and I gotta tell you, my gaydar is like totally shot, okay? 27 years in the Army, we were never allowed to talk about sex, so I have like no gaydar, okay? Yeah. I always knew I had a sense that a few of my soldiers who were gay or straight, they acted, you know, like I gotta tell you, my lesbian soldiers were my best soldiers. Right. They were the only ones that never got pregnant, the only ones I didn't have to get out of jail, I didn't have to worry about their child care issues. They were just soldiers, they just did their job, they were amazing. So, you know, so I could see that once in a while, you know. Mm-hmm. But the things that you see an awful lot, that for me, and you guys might want to like chime in if you have other experience, is when they don't talk about their boyfriend or partner, or their boyfriend or their husband, okay, in conversations. Or when they're hesitant to talk about like number of sexual partners, or when they're hesitant to talk about for lack of a better word, just the stereotypical female in a partnership role model. You know, yes.
Well, I had a patient like that.
Okay.
Back last semester. And I guess, like, looking back on it now, all the, like hallmark signs, I guess you could say, were there. But
yeah.
I was just, like, so oblivious to it.
I remember.
Yeah, the girls that are in my clinical group should know this story. But I was hooking up a lead, like leads for telemetry, and this woman just came back. Like, I don't remember if she came back from surgery or she was being admitted. I don't remember. But she had what I thought was like friend, sister, maybe, you know, I'm not really relative of some sort sitting in the room, and they're just like chatting it up, you know. I'm just kind of like chiming in every now and then, hooking up her leads and everything. And the nurse is like asking her questions. Like, I guess she was being admitted. She was like filling her chart in or whatever. And then later, like, me and the nurse are just like talking and everything. She said something about them being like a lesbian couple, and I was like, what? You know? And then she was like, you didn't notice all the hair on her chest? And I was like, well, you know, I noticed it, but I was just like, okay, cool. You know, she was like, Evan, she's taking testosterone. And I was just like, no way. And she was like, yeah, were you not listening to their conversation? She was like, yeah, they were talking about like gay marriage. And I was like, oh my God.
Oh,
she was like,
I
cannot believe you. I was like, well, I just kind of like, I wasn't thinking about it.
Right.
I was just like more concentrated, like, right on white. And, like, you know, trying to get my leads right. And then like what they were actually talking about. It was just so funny.
Yeah, one of the things that I have trouble with, especially in the military population, is husbands are often deployed. And so it is very common for two women to come into an OB appointment. To bring your friend, she's my surrogate husband while he's deployed, that kind of thing. So it's hard for me to recognize when it's two women because that's the way they want to be, or if it's two women just because they're friendly. And I got to tell you, girls are much more friendly with each other than men would ever be.
There's
a great, if you want to have fun, there's a YouTube video, what if men acted like women act around their friends,
yes.
You know, and it's like two guys
yes.
doing typical girl behavior, and it's like, woo, and so that behavior is kind of confusing, so I don't know how to recognize them, my gaydar is shot, but just know that they are out there, and you need to respond to them, and the most important thing is that it doesn't matter what you think. Okay, you need to be able to judge your behavior, or you need to be able to use your behavior in order to help them achieve wellness, and that is all there is to it. It doesn't matter what behavior they have. It doesn't matter what you think about their behavior. Your job is to help all of your patients achieve wellness, regardless. Okay, all right. So the sexual response cycle. Okay, your book gives a very good description of the sexual response cycle. I really like it. It's broken up into these 1, 2, 3, 4 phases: excitement, plateau, orgasmic, and resolution. And the excitement phase is, and each of these four phases are different for men and for women. Okay, there's a physiologic response that is similar. How they get there is different. Okay, the excitement phase, the heart rate increases, breathing increases. They tend to get a little flush in their cheeks. Things start to warm up a little bit. Okay. Plateau is usually during intercourse or during the procedure itself, so to speak. As things there's congestion, there's tension, things are warming up, things are building, things are getting ready, but they're not there yet. And then of course the orgasmic phase, which is all about contractions. Oh, I forgot. Let's go back to this whole things moving out of the way. I put that in because I thought that was interesting. What is that? Things moving out of the way.
So that you can have a...
Okay, so the uterus has to get out of the way. The cervix has to get out of the way. So during penile vaginal intercourse, the cervix actually tightens and pulls away from the vagina to make more space in the vagina. The man's testicles also rise and go up into his body so that they're not swinging and causing pain and so that the penis isn't bumping into things. Okay, we want to make as much room as it can and so the two get out of the way of each other. Okay, so that's what things moving out of the way means. And then orgasmic is contractions and release. Okay, the book talks only about the male orgasm, which I thought was funny in a female in a woman's health book. Okay, but any of you who are in this room who have ever had an orgasm must recognize that there's an awful lot of contractions that goes on during the orgasm. Okay, it is. It's a series of sharp peristalsic contractions. Okay. Now, the reason I say that is because when we start talking about oxytocin, what are the four things that oxytocin does? For those of you who did your reading over the summer, it makes contractions, right? Okay. Oxytocin is primarily responsible for muscle contraction. Okay. Spasmodic muscle contraction. And it does four things. It makes you sneeze. It makes your uterus contract. It makes your myoepithelial cells contract, and it makes your uterus contract. Isn't that interesting? Okay, so it's ovarian contractions, vaginal contractions, myoepithelial contractions, and contractions inside your nose. I don't know what to call them. Which is why, by the way, women sneeze like this, achoo, 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 and men sneeze like this, achoo! Because men are not as sensitive to pulsatile oxytocin surges, and women are. It's why women are multi-orgasmic and men are not, okay? Because you guys are more sensitive to oxytocin, okay? It's not an accident. Okay? And so that's the contractions and release, okay? The man releases, obviously, the semen there's a series of muscular contractions from inside. It pushes the semen out of the seminal vesicles and through the urethra. And the women have contractions, but the opposite, coming in, because they're going to grab the semen and pull it up into their cervix and into their uterus. Okay, and then there's resolution, which is rest and recover. Okay, and men and women are very different in how we rest and recover. Okay, the female resolution is much, much shorter than the male. Males are like hours. Women are like minutes. Okay, and that's why you guys can be a multi-orgasmic, and very few men can orgasm more than two or three times a day. You know, you guys can do it, like, I'm so jealous. But you guys ever hear the joke about, so God finished making Adam and Eve, and he said, okay, Adam and Eve, gather close, I got a couple of extra parts, okay? I got stuff I want to give, but I don't know who to give them to. You guys are both kind of perfect as you are, but I got two extra things. And I said, okay, all right, well, what are they, God? And he says, well, the first one is the ability to pee standing up. And Adam's like, oh, I gotta have it, I gotta do it, I can run out even the snow, I can pray, I gotta have it. And Eve like, whatever, if it means that much to you, take it. So God says, okay, Adam, you have the ability to pee standing up. He's like, take it, puppy, right? He's all excited. And so Eve says, all right, what do you have for me? What are the leftovers I get? And God smiles and says, multiple orgasms. But it's because of your ability to respond to oxytocin in repetitive pulsatile surges that your resolution phase on women is much, much smaller. Okay, there is a brief period of relaxation and rest. Oftentimes for men, that's sleep, because we're not coming back, we're done. Okay, whereas women will rest but not sleep. Okay, but an oxytocin surge has a hangover effect of sleepiness, okay? Which is why women when they're contracting in labor will get very, very sleepy, between 8 and 10 centimeters, okay? They become very oxytotic, they become very sleepy. It's why breastfeeding makes people sleepy. Why breastfeeding women always complain of fatigue, because they're sleepy, because it's oxytocin. It's why when you read to a toddler a bedtime story, you and the toddler get sleepy, because oxytocin, okay? You get an oxytocin surge whenever you do anything profoundly loving and cute, and it makes you sleepy, okay? It's why there are bedtime stories. We cuddle with our kids, and then they get sleepy, because they release oxytocin, and it makes them sleep. Mm-hmm. Isn't that fascinating? God, I love oxytocin. It's like my favorite thing ever. It's a love hormone. All right. Now, I thought this was a wonderful quote, so I decided to put it in your slides. Sexual health requires a positive, respectful approach to sexuality and sexual relationships, as well as the possibility of having pleasurable and safe sexual experiences free of coercion, discrimination, and violence. Okay? I absolutely love that. That is perfect. That is what everybody needs to have. Okay? A positive, respectful approach to sexual relationships, free of coercion, okay? I love it, it's perfect. There was a great article a couple of months ago on the internet that was a letter to my daughter, I want you to have great sex, which is an odd, provocative topic, right? Okay? And you think about it, and the guy was saying, I have great sex, my wife has great sex. Because she has great sex, we both have great sex, and we have a wonderful relationship. So why would I not want my daughter to have great sex? I want my daughter to have great sex. You know, and it's hard to say that. I want all of you to have great sex. Wow. I can't say that to my 17-year-old daughter, though, right?
No.
You gotta kind of couch it a little different, right? Someday, I want my daughter to have great sex. Not at 17. When she's 25.
Well, she gets to 26, so she
when she hits 26. Exactly. Yeah. So she can make children, right? I want her to, but I want her to find a healthy, safe relationship, and I want her to have great sex. And so someday I will teach her all about how to have great sex, but it'll come later because her mother is just not going to do it.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. Like, my oldest son has just admitted to engaging in sex.
Oh my God.
And you know, he's 20. He turns 21 in January. And he's in, you know, he's a junior in college. He's been dating the same girl since he was a freshman and a sophomore in high school. And so, you know, I recognize this. You know. And so I'm like, all right, do you know about the G spot? You gotta find the. So I need. Pull him aside and tell him about all the tricks of the trade.
I feel so awful.
Now that you can.
Now that I can, exactly, because now it's okay. It's okay to be bad at it when you first start. Nobody got up and hit a home run first time they held a bat in their hand. Yeah, but you get better with practice. Okay. Dimensions, okay, so this is the one we're talking about, homosexuality, bisexuality. All right. Assessment of sexual and reproductive health. It's very important to establish a trusting relationship free of personal bias, or with at least an awareness of your personal bias, with the folks that you're working with, okay? And that's sometimes very, very difficult. An awful lot of people have sexual dysfunctions and refuse to admit it. And definitely won't tell their healthcare providers about it. Just like people have hemorrhoids and won't tell their healthcare providers about it. I'm sorry, you got an asphalt, but we'll fix it, you know? But you gotta let it happen. You gotta tell somebody in order to make it happen, but they have to feel safe. And they have to feel that they can trust you in order to tell you about these issues. Okay. The most common sexual disorder is decreased sexual desire, and there's this tool called the DSDS, which I'll post on Blackboard, and it basically says, do you like having sex? Are you happy when you have sex? Are you happy with the amount of sex you have? Do you orgasm? And are you pleased that you do or don't orgasm? Basically. And then there's a few other questions that rule out medical problems that could cause, you know, this sexual dysfunction. And if there's no medical problems, it becomes this decreased sexual desire, and it becomes something that we can treat. Okay, the book has some wonderful nursing diagnoses on page 160, and it mentions the Plissett model. I absolutely love the Plissett model, and I'm going to post an article for you guys on Blackboard about talking about sexual health with your patients, okay? And it uses the Plissett model. Plissett model, P is permission giving, okay? Every time, and it happens all the time, women will come and they will say, ever since my baby was born, I've just not wanted to have much sex, okay? And I used to like sex and I would like to have more sex. My husband really wants to have more sex, and I need to know how to do it. And I say, well, it starts with having fun. Permission giving. Do whatever floats your boat. It doesn't matter what it is. You want to dress up like a French maid? Dress up like a French maid. You want him to tie you to the bed and spank you? By all means. You want to tie him to the bed and spank him? Do it. Lick his butt. Do whatever you want to do. Nothing matters. Okay? Because if you go back to the definition of sexual health, okay, it's all about being free to explore and being happy with what you're doing and have positive emotions regarding sex. And there are no bad sex as long as it fits that 2006 definition, free from coercion, free from physical violence, you know, that kind of thing. If you want it, reach on out and grab it. Have fun with it, and let it happen. And that's the best way to fix most of the decreased sexual desire. Because it becomes, pardon the pun, a self-licking ice cream cone, okay? It starts where you start with this kind of decreased sexual desire, and then it's sex, you know, is not really fulfilling and not orgasmic, and then it becomes just work, and you sweat, and you're dirty, and you don't want to have sex again because it's like going to the gym because you're not getting anything out of it, and then it just gets worse and worse and worse, right? And so it starts with permission giving, with the, I want to do this. Let's start by reading each other sexy stories. And, you know, let's build up to living out a couple of these stories, whatever. Okay, but it all starts with permission giving. And you'd be amazed how effective it is to just tell a woman, you know, you're allowed to enjoy sex, that you're supposed to enjoy sex, and that you're supposed to orgasm every single time you have sex, Okay? And if you're not orgasming every single time you have sex, you got some work to do. We can make that better. Okay? And the beautiful thing about women is 99% of sex is in here. Okay? It's not the physical contact of the, like a man needs to have someone to stroke his penis in order to orgasm. Women don't need that. Women can orgasm, you know, because this is your sexual organ, not these. Okay? These help you get there. But this is the sexual organ, right? And so so just freeing the mind and opening them up to the possibilities often goes an awful long way.
Communication.
And yeah, exactly. Effective communication. I like when you do that. I don't like when you do that. And it's amazing how hard it can be, especially when you're young, to tell someone, you know what, I really like it when you put hickeys on my butt. Fine. Hickeys on your butt. Got it. You know, how do you, 25 years old, tell someone you like to be tied to the bed? That's hard to tell somebody, right? Much easier when you're 30 and 40, but it's hard at 25. But,
oh no, I still remember being 25.
Yeah. But so anyway, the key to positive sexual health is to having permission. Okay. And then LI talks about like I'm blanking now. But there's specific instructions, and you know, okay, so you've done that. Now, let's move to the next step. Do you know where the clitoris is? Do you know how to stimulate the clitoris? What best way is it to stimulate the clitoris? What's too much? What's not enough? Are you comfortable touching yourself? Are you not comfortable touching yourself? We were talking about spinbarkite, and you're like, ew, spinbarkite. You gotta touch yourself. Okay, just part of the rules.
Well, okay. Let me ask you something.
Yeah.
But don't you think another reason why women aren't used to having orgasms as much as men? Because, and culturally wise, it's promoted for men to masturbate and
sure.
Not necessarily women.
Yeah.
Because I know, like with sons and everything like that, you know, they have a more open conversation with the father about masturbation.
Sure.
But mothers and daughters don't really discuss
it
that.
It goes right back to that "I want my daughter to have great sex" article, right? There is a cultural taboo against women having enjoying sex. There just is. Mm-hmm. And that's why sexual dysfunction among women is so much more prevalent than it is among men. Okay? And there's some talk out there about like this pink pill thing, that it's kind of like the woman's Viagra. It doesn't, you know, make the clitoris hard. But it enhances, you know, like serotonin levels and allows you to engage more readily in intercourse. And there's, you know, talk out there about like, well, you know, it never came before because men don't care if women have sex. I got to tell you, as a husband, I want my wife to be as horny as often as possible, right? that's a win-win,
right?
You know? So I'm thinking, it's not like there are researchers out there going, you know what, I found out how to give a woman an orgasm by doing this, but I'm not going to tell anyone about it. Are you kidding? You'd be a billionaire if you could teach that kind of skill, right?
Right.
So I don't think it's that. I think it's just that women are far more complicated than men are when it comes to that. And you know, it's hard to even talk about it.
Yeah.
Okay? All right, so achieving the Healthy People 2010 goals, 2020 goals. Healthy People 2020, on a population scale, we're looking to decrease our unintended and closely spaced pregnancies to less than 10%. We want to space our pregnancies out by at least 24 months. We want at least 31% of babies being more than 2 years apart, more than 24 months apart.
Why? I'm sorry, why within 24 months?
Because 24 months is considered the time it takes your body to recover from a pregnancy.
So it's
14 months after pregnancy, and then you get pregnant again, okay?
Okay.
And then if you wait 14 months and you get pregnant, pregnancy is a 10-month period, the babies are 24 months apart.
All right, so I know a girl. Mm-hmm. Her first kid just turned one, yesterday.
Right.
Her second kid is due in December.
That's a little quick.
Okay, that's
like Irish
twins. Exactly, that's called Irish twins. It's almost Irish twins. But Irish twins is when they're less than 12 months apart.
She had twins in December, and a year later she had twins in December. They're like a week apart.
That's
so
rough.
She has four kids.
But that's hard on the body, okay? In America, not so bad. It increases our risk of spontaneous miscarriages, and it increases our risk a little bit of preterm birth, kind of. But it's not too bad to do that two times, even three times. But it can be really hard on the body. And by the way, it's all formula feeding. We're going to talk about lactation amenorrhea and about how pregnancy, how breastfeeding protects you against pregnancy. When you formula feed, I have pregnant women come back for their 6-week postpartum visit. pregnant all the time when they're formula feeding.
Six.
Never when they're breastfeeding.
I complain about this all the time.
Yep, yes, ma'am.
How is it the breastfeeding prevents from getting pregnant and
we'll talk about that later. We got to get there first. Let's work through this.
Next.
Oh, the other one is involving men in family planning. Too often, contraception is woman's work, and men just ignore the whole woman's health perspective. And so involving men, and it starts with inviting them. Okay, I do a talk on the role of the father in breastfeeding, and everybody thinks I'm crazy because I teach men how to breastfeed, but there's a purpose, okay? Because I'm involving men in family planning. All right, contraception.
Yay.
There is a huge, huge spectrum when it comes to contraception, okay? From the natural family planning methods to hormonal methods to injectable methods, implantable methods, sterile, surgical methods. Okay, it's a huge topic. I got a big old book on my desktop if you want to borrow it. Okay, but next to all the methods that I could find, I put little numbers by it. Okay, the first number is the typical use, and the second number is perfect use. Okay, so natural family planning method. Typically, 75% of women will not get pregnant when using natural family planning. Okay, it has a 25% failure rate. However, if you're really good at it and you do it perfectly, you can get that number up into 91%. Okay, natural family planning is generally it's kind of a big umbrella that talks about things like knowing your menstrual cycle, understanding when you ovulate, abstaining from intercourse during certain periods during your menstrual cycle, the whole spin bark kite thing, and understanding what your basal body temperature means. That's all natural family planning, okay? Having sex when you know you're not fertile, okay? There's a fertility awareness method is part of that. Fertility awareness method focuses a lot on knowing when you are most likely to conceive, knowing what day of the month you ovulate, one day of your menstrual cycle you ovulate, and when to avoid or have intercourse in order to meet your goals. That's the fertility awareness method. Coitus interruptus, the old pray and spray method, pray and spray, can be very, very good, okay, 96% with perfect use. But the typical use is pretty low, okay? You gotta really trust somebody to use the pray and spray method. And it's been my experience that couples, and I've had couples who use it for 10 years, okay, and never get pregnant, okay? You gotta kind of enjoy semen in order to make that work. I personally, I'm like, eh, no.
How do you really feel, Rachel? Let's talk about it.
Yeah, you gotta talk about, you gotta kind of enjoy semen to make it work. Otherwise, you know, what I mean is that couples who use ejaculation in the fun of orgasm, they can use that the coitus interruptus really well, okay? Because he's always coming outside the body. Come on my tits, come on my face, whatever, right? We talked about permission giving, right? If you want someone to come on your tits, then let them come on your tits. I don't care, okay? And if that is part of fun for you, then you're a coitus interruptus. You're someone who could successfully use it. Because he'd get in trouble if he didn't give you what you want, right? So that's how that works. Lactation amenorrhea. We're going to talk about this more during breastfeeding. But understand that in order to lactate, your body has to shut down the ovaries. And your ovary, your HPO cycle, does not happen during lactation, okay? The hormones, because lactation is a low estrogen time in your life. So there's very, very little estrogen. And if there's no estrogen, there is no FSH and LH surge, there is no proliferation of the uterus, there is no menstrual cycle. And the average woman has her first period about 9 months postpartum, gets pregnant about 14 months postpartum, and has a baby every 24 months. That's the way the human body, the mammalian structures are designed to work. You see the same thing in cows, you see the same thing in all of our dairy animals, because we really control their fertility very closely. But they'll nurse their offspring for a certain number of months, then they'll go dry, then they'll get pregnant again. That's just the natural phase. That's how it works. And it is an extremely effective form of contraception. 98.6% effective with perfect use, okay? And there are four rules to perfect use. Rule number one, baby has to be exclusively breastfeeding. You give the baby a bottle, you introduce solid foods, it is no longer exclusive breastfeeding, okay? The definition is 85% or more of their feedings have to be from the breast, have to be breast milk, be they directly from the breast or pumped and bottle fed, it doesn't matter. Yeah. Rule number two, baby has to be less than 6 months old. If you're more than 6 months old, you're more likely to return to ovarian function. Like I said, the average woman has her first menstrual cycle at 9 months. But average means two standard deviations from the mean. It could be as early as 6 months, okay? So baby is less than 6 months old. One in four women after the baby is 6 months old will ovulate first and then menstruate. And that's a bad one because those folks never even had a period. They just came up pregnant again. Okay, because they ovulated first and they never had that warning sign. And that leads you to rule number three, and that is that you can't have periods. If a woman is having menstrual cycles, they are ovulating, and or you have to assume they're ovulating, and they can't use breastfeeding as a form of contraception anymore. Okay,
that's true.
And so, lactation amenorrhea, yes, breastfeeding is a form of contraception. And what often happens is you have people talk about, I was breastfeeding and I got pregnant. Really? How many times a day were you giving them a bottle? Well, about half and half. Okay, you weren't breastfeeding. Or, when did your periods come back? At 4 months. You broke the rule, okay? Or, when did you get pregnant? When he was 8 months old. Okay, more than 6 months old, you're no longer using lactation amenorrhea. Okay, that's why there's a big difference between typical use and perfect use. And 49%, by the way, that's just the number of women who breastfeed for 6 months or more. Okay, it's 49%. And in abstinence, your book says it's a 0% failure rate. I got to tell you, abstinence failed Mary, okay? There isn't any perfect contraception. I use that when I teach about contraception. People are always like, well, I can't use Depo because a friend of mine got pregnant using Depo. I'm like, nothing's perfect. Right. Abstinence even failed Mary. But abstinence is a pretty darn reliable form of contraception, right? The only time that abstinence gets in the way is when we're kind of doing the whole pray and spray thing and coming too close to the birth canal. I've heard, you know, myths about little girls getting pregnant who never had penile intercourse, and it was because she let him ejaculate on her. Okay. I don't know if I believe it, but whatever. Just, if you never touch, you know, pregnancy is a communicable disease, okay? And it's spread through semen, okay? If you have no contact with semen, kind of hard to get pregnant. Like always, people always say, "Well, what's in the water out of Fort Bragg that makes people so pregnant? That makes people." You know, I always say, "It's not water that's making people pregnant. Something a little bit more viscous.
Yeah,
a little bit thicker." Barrier methods. The beautiful thing about barrier methods, they're inexpensive. The amazing thing about barrier methods is that they prevent sexually transmitted diseases, or at least they help. Okay? And so anybody who's not in a mutually monogamous, committed relationship, no matter what, needs to be using barrier methods to prevent against all those wonderful communicable diseases. They have to be used prior to intercourse. Yes, you have to put the diaphragm in before you put the penis in, or it doesn't work. You have to put the condom on before you put the penis in, or it doesn't work. You have to use it before the intercourse begins, and that can sometimes be difficult. Okay? They often require water-based lubricants. You never want to use a petroleum-based lubricant when you're using any latex. Petroleum breaks down latex. So KY is perfectly okay. Astroglide, I don't think so. But vegetable oil or mineral oil, absolutely not. Anything petroleum-based can break down the latex in your barrier methods. Okay? What's that? You never heard that? What, baby oil?
Vegetable oil,
I was going to say. Baby oil is what I was looking for.
Oh.
But people put, like, you wouldn't believe what people put in themselves. Okay. I had a guy once who used to put snakes in his penis.
You want what?
Yes, little garter snakes. He put them in. There's a sexual predilection, a fetish. Would they put the snakes in? And we know because they had hamsters too, yeah. Because he it slipped out of his hands and went into his bladder, and it was like giving him, like it was biting his bladder and causing bladder spasm. He couldn't get it out.
Oh my God.
It slipped.
It told him it?
Yeah, yeah. Wow. It was in his urethra and it slipped out of his hands and it went in. I know, right? What's that? It goes back to the whole positive, you know, sexual relationships.
Permission.
You got to accept permission.
No permission.
He didn't have that snake.
You want to put a snake in your penis? Put a snake in your penis. Keep it away from my penis.
Just don't let go.
The beautiful thing about barium methods, there are very few side effects associated with barium methods, except for like dermatitis, because you're sensitive to latex, or you have a reaction to astroglide, or whatever. And the key is consistent, correct use. Everybody knows how to put a condom on? I hope. No. I'm going to say it anyway. Okay? First step, man has to be erect. Okay? A soft penis will not take a condom. Okay? You then take your condom, you put it on the top, there should be a little gap for the semen to come in. Okay? Either they have a little reservoir on top, or you're a little loose on top, and you roll it on down to the bottom. Okay? And that's how you do it. And then, as soon as orgasm occurs, the penis has to come out, holding the condom as you pull the penis out, and then you take the penis, then you take the condom off the penis, okay? You do not allow, men should not allow themselves to get soft inside the vagina while they're wearing a condom, because it will fall off and leak, and away you go, okay? And your condoms need to be inspected for holes and leaks and that kind of stuff. There's an expiration date, exactly, and all those things apply. By the way, the same rules apply for female condoms as well. Female condoms need to be applied before. It's usually you don't have to worry if the man's erect or not, but you have to put it in, and then as soon as they come, take the condom out, okay? It's contact with the birth canal and semen is what makes people pregnant. All right, barrier methods. Diaphragms are going away. I've never, ever fit a woman for a diaphragm. We had one woman ask for a diaphragm once in the last 3 years, and it was like, I don't have a diaphragm fitting kit. We had to get one of the old midwives who had done it once to put it in. Okay? They're not very effective. Typical use is 80%. Perfect use is 94%. Cervical caps, it's literally a thick rubber cap that pop on the top of the cervix. Very ineffective. 60% in Paris women and 80% in leprous women. What's that?
So the cap is like smaller than the diaphragm?
Yes. It's very small. It's almost like a soda bottle cap, but it's made out of rubber, and you just pop it up in there, and it sits on top of the cervix. Yeah, and it's much more firm. A diaphragm, you actually fold in half and slip it in, and it's got that rubber ring, or it's got that metal ring, and it opens up like a parachute up against the back wall of the birth canal, of the vagina. A cervical cap does not. You have to literally put it on the cervix. Okay, and it wiggles around and it falls off. Much more work than it's worth. Condoms, we talked about that. Condoms are pretty good. 97% for male condoms, 95% for female condoms. It's a typical use where we start to have problems because they get soft before they pull out, or they put it on late or whatever. Spermicides, again, pretty good with perfect use. Not so good with typical use. We no longer recommend using Nonoxyl-9 in condoms. It tends to break down the condom. Use one or the other, not both. Contraceptive sponge, these things went off the market a very long time ago. I heard they came back and then they went away. There's a wonderful Seinfeld bit about it, but I've never seen a contraceptive sponge, and they don't work very well either. Again, that's Paris women, nulliparous women. So women who've had babies, women who haven't had babies, okay?
They use it a lot still in porn.
Do they? In porn?
I watched
a
documentary.
Huh. Interesting. I always just assumed they were on the pill. All right. Oral contraceptives are the most commonly used form of birth control here in America. They are they're up to 99.9% effective with perfect use. There are several different types: monophasic, biphasic, triphasic, fourphasic, which I guess would be called quadphasic. And it's based on the dosage of estrogen. Some will kick up a little bit to match the menstrual cycle better. Others will just be monophasic, which is just one dose all the way across. Anytime you put a woman on contraception, an oral estrogen-based contraception, you have to teach them about abdominal pain, chest pain, headaches, eye problems, and unilateral swelling. Aches, okay? DVT, okay? Estrogen causes blood clots, period. End of sentence. It increases their risk dramatically, especially if they're a smoker, especially if they're over 35. So anytime you put a woman on birth control pills with estrogen in it, you have to talk about blood clots. And there are non-contraceptive benefits to come to estrogen-containing birth controls, as we were talking about earlier. Problems with dysmenorrhea, control of the cycles, that kind of thing.
Acne.
So there are acne, exactly. There are a lot of side effects that they help with. My favorite is to use Yaz or Yasmin for women who have polycystic ovarian syndrome. Oh, it makes them all better. It works so well that I'll put a woman on Yaz even if she has a Paragard in, who's already using contraception, because it just controls her symptoms well. Then there's the low-dose progesterone-only pills. They're called the mini pill or the NorQD. they're safer for breastfeeding women than the estrogen-containing birth control. And so we use them primarily the first 6 months postpartum. But they don't have the risks of blood clots that estrogen does. So they're good for women who have a history of blood clots, who want to take pills. Transdermal patches are exactly like the oral contraceptives, except you wear them on your skin instead of you swallow them. And a vaginal contraceptive ring, very similar. The beautiful thing about both of these is you put them in for 3 weeks at a time, and then you take them off, okay? The patch, I think, is a week. Has anyone ever used a patch?
Yeah.
I think it's a week.
Yeah,
is it a week?
It's every week you have, you get a patch, you put one on every week for 3 weeks, and then you do 1 week off so you can have your period, and then you go back three more weeks.
It's like a dirty
bandage. What's that? They're like a band-aid?
Like, yeah, it's like dirt around.
They leave a ring around them, and they cause a lot of skin irritation, too. Being a lactation consultant, I never use any of these, just the progesterone-only pill once in a while. But here's the interesting thing. 99.5% is not much higher than 98.6%, is it? So breastfeeding all by itself means you don't need to use any kind of hormonal contraception. As a matter of fact, the CDC no longer recommends hormonal contraceptive for a breastfeeding woman who's less than 6 months postpartum. Because it doesn't give you an improve, it doesn't improve things very much. And both estrogen and progesterone are associated with early termination of breastfeeding. So you're putting breastfeeding at risk and you're not really helping anybody. Okay? Most American obstetricians will say, oh, that's a lie, only because most American women don't breastfeed. Okay? It's not that the method fails, it's that people don't use the method properly. Okay? Now, other ones, I'm going to move on. You don't want to put a person on birth control pills for the first time without doing a health assessment, okay? Because they're not benign. They have some major changes. So we always want to make sure we get a health assessment and look at their blood pressure. Because any woman with high blood pressure has a risk of having a significant elevation in blood pressure thanks to the estrogen. And so we will often put them on birth control pills and have them come back in a couple of weeks and then again in a month to watch what effect it has on their blood pressure. They should have an initial 3 month follow-up after putting it on. Because here's the trick. You gotta try it on and see if you like it, okay? What often happens is we put people on birth control pills and it takes 3 months for the body to adjust to it. They'll get heavy bleeding or no bleeding or cramping or acne or something like that. So for the first 3 to 6 months, your body is getting used to the fact that you're controlling your HPO axis and not doing a good job of it, okay? And then it tends to settle down. So you want to bring them back in 3 months to increase your compliance rate, because a lot of women will stop taking the pills and not come back. And then they go, my friend got pregnant taking the pill. No, she got pregnant not taking the pill. Okay. And that happens an awful lot. So you have to adjust it. And there's a book called Dickey's. I don't know, I guess it's funny, but there's a book called Dickey's Contraceptive Management. And there are literally 1,000 different types of birth control pills. And there's these charts, and so a woman says, I'm having problems with irregular bleeding on day 9. Oh, bleeding on day 9, you need to increase your progesterone. So we're going to switch from this pill to that pill with a little bit more progesterone. Or I got a problem with hair growth. Oh, well, in that case, we need to decrease your androgens. So we're going to switch you from this pill to that pill. So it takes a little fine-tuning. Not everybody in this room can take the same birth control. You just can't. Okay? It has to be adjusted. And then they usually only give 4 refills, so you come back every year to reevaluate your need for birth control pills. Okay? Now, non-contraceptive benefits, it controls your menstrual bleeding, and it mediates menopausal symptoms. It's a wonderful hormone replacement therapy. It is basically birth control pills. Okay? It's just a high estrogen form of birth control pill, and that can control your menopausal symptoms. Contraindications, I mentioned these earlier. No smoking, no one over 35, no uncontrolled hypertension, no undiagnosed abnormal vaginal bleeding. Why not?
Because you don't know where that bleeding's coming from.
Exactly. That could be, it could be uterine cancer, right? Not dysmenorrhea. And so they do like endometrial biopsies and do everything they can to prove it's not cancer before they put those women on birth control pills. And diabetes of more than 20 years duration with vascular complications. So if you've got vascular complications, you're more likely to have DVT. You're more likely to get really sick with your birth control pills. And so most women who are taking birth control pills have not had diabetes for more than 20 years. Okay. Other problems, anyone who has a history of pulmonary embolism or DVT, anyone who has cerebral vascular disease, these should be no-brainers, okay? Anything that increases your risk of blood clots, you don't want to give anybody birth control pills with estrogen, okay? Anyone who has an estrogen-dependent neoplasia, can you think of what those are?
Breast cancer.
Breast cancer, exactly. Or anyone with active liver disease, because that's where these things are processed. This is aches, headaches, breakthrough, well, no, this is an aches. Troublesome side effects. So these are the side effects that a lot of women get when they're on birth control pills, and you need to counsel people. You might notice these things, okay? Ride it out for a few months, see if it goes away on its own. If it doesn't, come on back in. We'll adjust your contraception to another type of birth control pills. But don't stop taking the birth control pills and then have sex, because you will get pregnant, okay? Emergency contraception. Used to be pretty controversial, not so controversial anymore, okay? Emergency contraception is usually progesterone only. And what it is, it's a huge dose of progesterone given within 24 to 48 or 72 hours of the unprotected intercourse, and it forces the ovaries to stop working, okay? It just slows things down for a couple of days and makes it so the ovaries won't release an egg and that the fallopian tubes won't go looking for an egg. Okay, and it doesn't impact the implantation of an established pregnancy. As a matter of fact, if we have a woman who has a history of repeated miscarriages, we put them on progesterone to protect the pregnancy. Okay, so Depo-Provera is not going to hurt an established pregnancy, and neither is emergency contraception. If the woman is already pregnant, it just don't give them a lot of side effects, and it just won't work. Okay. And then another form of emergency contraception is the copper-releasing IUD. We can actually put a copper IUD into the uterus within 24 to 72 hours, and that makes the uterus a very hostile environment to sperm. Okay, the uterus or sperm hates copper. Okay, you could literally put a penny in your uterus, and it has the same effect. Copper is very, very bad for sperm, and so if we have sperm hanging around in the uterus, waiting for an egg to land in there, the copper can kill all the sperm before it finds an egg. But it won't affect a fertilized egg and sperm. Mm-hmm. Once in a while, women get pregnant with an IUD in place, and we just take the IUD out, and we move on. But you don't even have to take the IUD out. You can just leave it there and take it out when the baby delivers. Okay. Depo-Provera is an injectable form of contraception, 99.7 to 99.7% effective. Very, very good, because it's not in anybody's control, right? It's in. She can't not take it. It's already in. And it lasts for 3 months. Depo means last forever, okay? Provera is progesterone, okay? So there's a Depo-Lupron, there's Depo-Provera, there's a few other Depo shots, and Depo means last for a long time. It has a preservative in the body, okay? The big problem with Depo-Provera is almost nobody will take it for an entire year. Very few women will tolerate the side effects for Depo-Provera for more than a couple of months. And so it has a very high failure rate, because less than 25% of women will take it for an entire 12-month cycle. Okay? It causes weight gain, it causes acne, it causes hair loss, pasty skin, bleeding irregularities. It's a real pain in the butt. And I always joke with my patients, I only use Depo for teenagers who shouldn't be having sex anyway. Because it makes them chubby and acne and hair where it doesn't belong, and no one wants to have sex with them anyway. What's up?
I had it. I was on that for 3 years.
Okay. Did you like it?
Hated it, because I went from 150 pounds to 205 pounds in a year.
There you go. That's Depo. It's and that's why most women won't take it.
That's why I said I
okay?
couldn't. Mine not agree.
There is also, and everyone ignores it, there's a black box warning on Depo that you can't take it for more than 2 years in a lifetime, because it can cause problems with bone absorption. They haven't linked it to osteoporosis yet, but there is a difference in the bone scans after 2 years of taking Depo.
With the density.
I put in it may be safe for breastfeeding mothers, but only after lactogenesis 2 occurs. And a lot of healthcare providers like to give it before you discharge from the hospital, and they are just dead wrong. Okay? It is the absence of progesterone that makes your lactogenesis 2 occur. And if I give you a big dose of progesterone, it lasts for 3 months, before your lactogenesis has happened, I may interfere with it. We don't exactly know, but we know that all breastfeeding women who take any form of contraception, any form of hormonal contraception, are more likely to not be breastfeeding at 8 weeks. It causes failure no matter what hormone you use. Okay? And like I said, there's a high refusal rate. I'm very upset because I'm not going to be able to get to the baby. Nexplanon, wonderful little rod. It slips right up here underneath your skin. It was called Implanon a few years ago, and then they changed it to Nexplanon with the next generation. They really didn't change the device, they just changed how we put it in. Okay, very effective at 99.9%. No law, it doesn't require any use. You just set it and forget it. The big problem with Nexplanon is it tends to cause irregular bleeding. The average woman has 3 7-day menstrual cycles in a 90-day period for 21 days of bleeding every 90 days. For the Nexplanon, that number is 40 days of bleeding every 90 days. So it doubles the amount of time you bleed, and it's not menstrual bleeding, it's breakthrough bleeding, irregular throughout the cycle. It can be a real pain in the butt. You got a hand up.
Can we skip this and go to the baby?
Can we skip this and go to the baby? Gosh, I want to. It's one of those things where everything is important, right? Paragard and Mirena, okay, two primary IUDs, extremely effective at 99.6 or 99.9, depending on which one you use. Paragard is a little bit less effective than the Mirena. And I put Mirena and Skyla together because they're very, very similar, made by the same people. Mirena is the big one, Skyla is the little one. Mirena lasts 5 years, Skyla lasts 3 years. Number one form of birth control used around the world, second only to breastfeeding. In America, not a very popular option, but it's very effective. I have no idea what this pains is. I don't teach pains. Okay, but the big thing to worry about when you put an IUD in is that we may have perforated the uterus. Okay, and if you perforate the uterus there, that's the P, right? It's probably like abdominal pain, infection.
Yes.
I don't worry about it because you teach everything. I teach it a different way. But the beautiful thing about perforating the uterus, if perforating the uterus is such a bad thing, then C-section should not happen, right? We can do a lot of damage to the uterus and it grows right back. Remember we talked about those interlaced muscle fibers? Mm-hmm. What happens if you perforate the uterus is it just closes right back down on it again, okay? It's not like you've got this bleeding wound inside your belly and you're gonna die. It's just you now have an IUD where it doesn't belong, okay? And it doesn't work if your IUD is in your pelvis, right? It only works if the IUD is in the uterus. So that's a big deal. But the beautiful thing about them is you set it and forget it, you don't worry about it. The copper in the Paragard kills sperm, that's all it does. Okay, it doesn't affect your menstrual cycle, it has no changes at all. You just put it in there and leave it alone. A lot of women who use Paragard talk about heavier menstrual cycles, but not longer. So they bleed more during their menstrual cycle, they change their pads more often, but they don't have like 10 days of bleeding. They just have the normal one, but it's just heavier. And then the Mirena actually takes your periods away. 20 to 60% of women who use a Mirena will stop having periods by the end of the first year, which is kind of cool. I consider that a win-win. If you don't want to have babies, why have periods? It's wonderful. It just stops it. Because what it does, the progesterone in the uterus stops the estrogen from allowing the endometrial layer to proliferate. And if there's nothing to proliferate, there's nothing to shed. And so unlike the Seasonics and the other ones where you have estrogen running all the time and you build up proliferation and you have to stop and have a period every couple of months, with the Mirena you don't have to because the part that makes a period necessary just doesn't happen. Okay? So it's pretty cool stuff. We actually can use Mirena. It's indicated for women who have dysmenorrhea, who have you know, heavy or painful bleeding, we can use it and it'll take them away. We use it for soldiers a lot too. These are side effects. Irregular bleeding is on the Nexplanon and early in the Mirena, but not after 6 months. And then pelvic infections increase a little, but not a lot, just because the string is outside the uterus. And it's if you get a pelvic infection in the first 90 days after putting a Mirena in, it's bad. Okay, so if you could just avoid gonorrhea for 30 or 60 days, you're good. 6 years, you know, 2 or 3 years later, your risk is not elevated. It's only when we first put it in because we've violated that cervical mucus. Okay. Sterilization, 99.5% on females and 99.9% on men. Okay, there are several different types of sterilization. They work pretty good. They're not perfect.
I love that.
Yep. The one thing that's really good about the male is that the male vasectomy and the man, you know, takes control, right? That's a good thing.
Yeah.
And if you change your mind, you can get a vasectomy reversed. You can't get a tubal reversed very well. They don't reverse very easy, but vasectomies do. And so, and an interesting phenomenon happens when I don't want any more babies becomes I can't have any more babies. There's an awful lot of buyer's remorse. And anywhere from 50 to 75% of women who either have their tube side or their partner has his tube side will regret having it done. And an awful lot will take steps to get them reversed. Yes, ma'am.
Why do they not let you or try not to, why is it an issue for you to have like a sterilization if you haven't had a baby yet?
Because you don't know what you're giving up. And there's an awful lot of regret that comes afterward. Same reason. Oh, Siri ratted you out. It's the same reason that we don't do tubal ligation to women under 26. You're not capable before 26 of controlling your impulses, and so there's an awful lot of buyer's remorse before the age of 26. Now, women who are over 30 who get their tube side, almost no buyer's remorse. But the young women in their 20s, they regret it an awful lot. All right. Clinical termination of pregnancy. I was shocked. Your slides have like 15 slides on abortion. And I'm like, okay, fine. It's a simple surgical procedure. I cut most of them out. Termination of pregnancy is an abortion. And in North Carolina, the law is that it has to happen before 20 weeks. Okay? I think I made a slide for you. Here you go. North Carolina abortion laws must be before 20 weeks. May perform after 20 weeks if the mother's life or health is in grave danger. That's kind of a spurious argument. That happens so incredibly rarely that it's almost not even worth worrying about. Usually when it happens, almost like 99.99% of the time when it does happen, mom's 28, 29 weeks, and you can just deliver the baby prematurely and move on with life. It's very, very rare that a woman would get like, and what they're talking about with life in danger is mom has breast cancer and needs to start chemotherapy. Mom has early onset preeclampsia and could end up with a stroke or that kind of stuff. But it's a very, very rare occurrence. Must be provided by a physician licensed to practice medicine in North Carolina. Healthcare facilities may refuse to provide abortions without consequence, and every facility that offers abortions has to present an annual statistical summary to the state of North Carolina. And you can find that here. Nurse's role during abortion care is the exact same you would during a DNC from a miscarriage. Okay? Guidance, testing, ultrasound, support, counseling, and information about contraception afterward. Okay? Two types of abortion is surgical and medical. Surgical, there are different techniques depending on how far along you are in pregnancy. D&E, DNX, DNC, all kinds of different techniques for that. And then medical termination, most often we use methotrexate or misoprostol. Methotrexate we use for tubal pregnancies, when somebody has an ectopic pregnancy. Mm-hmm. We use a shot of methotrexate, followed up in a couple days with another shot, and it breaks down the pregnancy and stops it from growing. And that's wonderful because it prevents having to have surgery to remove the tube, okay? So methotrexate is a wonderful option for that. But methotrexate is a cancer drug, okay? It stops all rapidly growing cells, and so it's a dangerous thing to use. You have to be real careful with it. In leukemia treatment, my daughter would get a run of methotrexate every 3 weeks, and they would give her a dose of methotrexate in her spinal fluid, and then an IV dose that ran for 24 hours, and then 48 hours later, she had to have a leucovorin antidote to stop the methotrexate from trying to kill her. So you have to do a methotrexate and then a leucovorin. We don't have to use leucovorin for the shots of methotrexate because it's a much smaller dose. Okay. Misoprostol, what's anyone know the other name for misoprostol? Cytotec. Anyone ever heard of Cytotec? Cytotec is an induction agent. We use it if we want to induce labor. You give you a pill every 4 hours, they start contracting like crazy, and they have a baby. Okay? The same thing happens if you're going to terminate a pregnancy very early on. We use it for our missed abortions where the baby has died and the body hasn't recognized it yet and we want to end this pregnancy. And we use it, of course, for medical termination. We use huge doses, like 800 micrograms instead of 25 micrograms, which is what we use for labor. And it's pretty effective most of the time. Yes?
I had a girlfriend that she lost her baby. The baby had died and was given that. But the thing that she wasn't prepared for was she felt like she was going through birth again.
Yep.
Because the way it was portrayed to her was that it was just, you take the pill, we'll have some discharge,
Yeah.
And that's it. And yeah. it was not the case whatsoever.
It's a hard road, okay? It literally initiates labor, okay? Mm-hmm. And the labor is less powerful at 10 weeks than it is at 40 weeks, but it initiates labor. A lot of cramping, a lot of pain, a lot of bleeding. You are going to pass products of conception. You are, yeah. Mm-hmm. And so we need to tell these folks that when we're doing it. Usually, counseling on these issues is up to the provider. Mm-hmm. It's very rare the nurse has much to do with that.
Yeah, because that kind of left a mental scar upon her.
Oh, sure, yeah.
Because
you got to prepare for it. Okay. And then this is the surgical termination. This is what I was talking about with the, like, the DNX, DNE, that kind of stuff. I thought I hid them. Oh, you know what it was? I hid these slides, but because I'm not going directly off my PowerPoint, they're still here. So give me a second. You don't need all that stuff. And we already talked about this. Yeah, see?
Move on.
Oh, let's talk about this a little bit. Second and third trimester. So this is a very common thing. You're going to see it. 1% of all second and third trimester babies do not survive and are not born alive. Okay, it's called an intrauterine fetal demise, and the process for delivering those babies is exactly the same as induction of labor. Okay, we start with our vaginal or intrauterine prostaglandins. We often give multiple doses, so it's a Cytotec or I never use it, so I don't remember it. I can't remember. It's a prostaglandin on a string, and you put it in the birth canal, and I'm blanking on the name. But anyway, it's a vaginal prostaglandin, and it softens the cervix and causes contractions and can get things ready to deliver. And then we will often, an intrauterine fetal demise, we'll often then finish up with Pitocin to induce labor and cause the birth to happen. Side effects are nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, cramping. I don't know anybody who uses intrauterine hypertonic solutions. This is more for an abortion with a living baby. And they put hypertonic solutions like high calcium, high sodium solutions in, and it kills the baby. And then they can deliver the baby.
Oh, gracious.
Yeah, I know, it's awful. Okay. Complications, cramping or bleeding are the most common. Infection and incomplete abortions are secondary. An incomplete is like the process starts but it doesn't finish, and they need to come back in and then later have a DNC or something. So we try the pills and it doesn't work, and then we have to bring them back into a DNC. Okay. Asherman syndrome and post-ovoidal syndrome are two very interesting complications. You see them much more in elective terminations, because the placenta is still adherent well to the uterine wall, and so there's a real part that's still there, you know, kind of, you know, trying to survive, right? Mm-hmm. And so what happens is, when they go in with their vacuums and they scrape the inside of the uterus, they damage the uterine wall, and it causes these irregularities in the uterine wall, and these irregularities in the uterine wall can cause infertility. Okay, but any woman who has an elective AB has a higher risk of spontaneous abortion on her next pregnancy and a higher risk of infertility. It's not ridiculous. It goes from like infertility goes from like 3% to 5%, and spontaneous abortion goes from like 25% to 40%, that kind of thing. But you see it an awful lot. Okay? And then our primary goal is education about short-term complications. Okay. Adoption, not even mentioned in the textbook. When it talks about all these other ways to end the pregnancy. And I think it's very important, so I wanted to add it in. Adoption is never mentioned, but there are three options when we talk about pregnancy counseling, okay? You can keep the baby, you can have an abortion, or you can give the baby to someone else, okay? Those are your three options. You got a baby, what are you gonna do with them, okay? My personal beliefs, there are hundreds and thousands of childless couples who want children. And it is a very complicated, very expensive process to get. I think that if you can make a child and you don't want it, you should give it to the people who want it, okay? That's kind of a win-win, right? That allows the baby to survive, and it allows somebody who doesn't have a child to have a child, and it saves you from having to raise a child. Of course, you still have to have the child. You still have to go through the whole pregnancy. You still have to go through the whole delivery, and there's an awful lot of emotional attachment that comes, and that can be difficult. I've known women who gave babies up for adoption, and I always tell them how brave they are, how that's a very difficult thing to do, but it's a very brave thing to do, and it's a very generous thing to do. So I thought that, you know, we should mention that at least a little bit. Okay? Can we take 5 minutes and
please.
Come back?
Yes, yes, please.
Go ahead. What is that? Was that an air horn?
Sorry.
Does it? I didn't, I looked right over it.
That
oh, okay.
Adoption may be considered after repeated attempts of pregnancy. Today there are fewer infants and children available for adoption.
Oh, that's part of infertility. That's not part of the pregnancy options counseling. So
yeah.
That's from the other perspective.
Gotcha.
That's for like, do you adopt? Do you do in vitro fertilization, or do you live without children? That's that argument. That's not the unwanted children, you know, for women who are having abortions.
Oh yeah,
right.
Yeah.
Okay. Are we going into chapter 7 now?
I think I'm going to skip right over infertility, even though I know Mrs. Cruxy wants to talk about it, and we're going to talk a little bit about fetal development and genetics because I think that's more important.
I like hormones.
Yes.
What's that?
I said I like
good stuff. Fun.
Endocrine is my favorite in anatomy.